Today's college football game on ESPNU is presented in high definition. The sun is shining in Raleigh, North Carolina, and the ribs are cooking. The beat goes on for the Wolfpack, hoping to paint another happy picture in the ACC. Today it's the Pack in Wake Forest, and one of the oldest rivalries in the ACC. Next. From Raleigh, North Carolina, it's an important ACC matchup on ESPNU. NC State hopes to continue their late season surge that would land them in a bowl game, while Wake Forest hopes to keep their ACC championship hopes alive, all presented by Allstate. Hi folks, Doug Bell alongside Charles Arbuckle. It's a gorgeous day just outside Carter-Finley Stadium. A little blustery, we'll see if that plays a factor today, but how about that Wolfpack Turf Monument, Buck? That is spectacular.
Doug, you see the water flowing? That's what NC State wants with wins. They want them to come like that water.
Dick Idle, a former Wolfpack player, actually designed that. A couple of outstanding quarterbacks in today's game. Riley Skinner has not thrown an interception in 132 straight passes. Of course, we called the game where he threw his last pick. Since then, he's been near perfection.
The thing with Riley Skinner is he's so effective moving outside of the pocket and making sure he gets the ball down the field. I really like how he's improved his game every single year. And with Wake Forest, if he's effective, they're usually effective.
Russell Wilson, a two-sport star at NC State, an outstanding baseball player, but right now concentrating on football. He has not thrown a pick in 142 tries. A young player who's getting better every game.
You know, they're feeding him more and more. Dana Bible said he's gotten better each and every time he plays. He missed a couple of games due to injury, Doug, but this guy is really, really effective.
Buck, you're right. Looking at the numbers, almost identical. In fact, as Wake Forest broke down the tape this week, they thought Wilson looked just like their guy, Riley Skinner. This should be a good one. NC State revved up at home today against Wake Forest, one of the oldest rivalries in the ACC. Next on ESPNU. Welcome back to Raleigh, North Carolina. The sun is shining, which is the good news. There is a chance for rain later, maybe perhaps in the fourth quarter. Here's what's on tap on this Saturday in Wolfpack country. Toys for Tots. Melissa will tell us all about a terrific program that Coach O'Brien has instituted here at NC State. We'll go inside the coach's office with our coach's crib segment. And what a matchup it was between these two schools two seasons ago. And as always, the buck stops right here at Carter-Finley Stadium. It's been a crazy season in the ACC, and it could get crazier today. Wake Forest hoping to put themselves in position to get to that ACC championship. They hold the tiebreaker over Florida State. Maryland holds the tiebreaker over the Demon Deacons. Wake Forest won the opening toss, will defer and kick off with Andrew Wright, soccer player, handling the kickoff duties, trying to kick it short and out of the hands of TJ Graham, but they don't do it. Graham fields it right up the middle, takes a good lick, but gets it out to the 33-yard line. 17 on the return, and that's where NC State will get their first go of this game against Wake with Russell Wilson at quarterback.
Well, Doug, we talked about Russell Wilson and how he's evolved, and Dana Bible has just been so high on this kid. They've had to tweak their offense a little bit. They had, remember, Matt Ryan when they were at Boston College, and then they came here, struggled at the quarterback position last year with a couple of different players. This offense is now designed to help Russell Wilson and be his best.
Andre Brown at tailback. Speedy wideouts on the outside, so he has plenty of weapons. Rolling out and has his man, and that is almost picked off and almost caught. Went right through the hands of the defender, but they say it's incomplete. Jarvis Williams was on the receiving end.
Well, you see this play fake very well setting it up, and then get everybody moving over. This Wake defense is so fast, but you're right, Doug. Great job by Jarvis Williams of going after, but Brandon G with a good coverage and able to stay right there and not allow him to catch that football.
Russell Wilson, the freshman from Richmond, Virginia.
We're going to take a look at this. It was taking a little while.
We're going to see if Williams actually came up with that. A pass that just went to the hands of the defender, and then Williams rolled over and caught it. So it's now upstairs, the review booth.
But very good rollout here. And this camera angle doesn't really show you, but Jarvis Williams with great reaching back and catching it in his hands. The ball looks like it comes out. Throw a little bit behind him. If he throws it in front, that might be a catch, and clearly it was not from that angle.
Yeah, that hit the ground. NC State played their best game of the season against Duke 1 week ago. One of the reasons the offensive line really came around and started to really mesh. Mears Green, what a terrific story, has applied for medical school. And up front, they're big and getting better. Andre Brown is the hoss in the backfield. On the outside, Williams, Spencer, and Hill give young Russ Wilson plenty of targets.
You know, Doug, the other thing about that offensive line that's so effective is that that's where Tom O'Brien really hung his hat at UVA and at Boston College. Had 10 offensive linemen drafted, so he really took a more prominent role this offseason to work with the offensive line.
So second down and 10. That was ruled incomplete. First carry for Andre Brown. Sidestepping some tacklers and moving forward for a nice gain of 5 yards. Up front for Wake Forest, the veterans, Matt Robinson. More aches and pains than we can discuss today, but he's back in the lineup. Curry, Arno, McClinic. Lots of games, all seniors, outstanding, especially Curry. And Alfonso Smith, trailing only Dre Bly in ACC history for most career interceptions. We'll see if he can match that mark today. Third down, back to Brown. Big gaping hole on the left side. He's going to have the first down. Chip Vaughn trips him up, picks up 4.
You know, Doug, what was the one thing that Tom O'Brien talked about and Dana Bible? They said, you know, we wanted Andre to work more on pressing the hole, but he still has the speed to get outside. This is a former high school All-American who ran track in high school, very good athlete, but he did a lot of this when they first got here, bouncing outside. But that was a time where it really called for. If he cut up a little bit sooner, he may have had a few more yards, but he still picked up the first down.
Unseasonably warm this time of year, 71 degrees. You see the wind surging upwards of 30 miles per hour. And it is a tornado watch in effect up until 8 p.m. in this area. Wilson to the outside, in and out of the hands of Jarvis Williams. Andre Brown has really come alive under the watch of Tom O'Brien, who described him really as a bouncer early in his career, always looking to break that long run. And he said that just doesn't work. Now he's become a powerful back. And when you do that, run hard every time, then the big runs will come.
He's also become more of an emotional leader. He's one of the senior leaders of this team. But he said he feeds off of Jamel Eugene, and they do a very good job of working together. And I think that's the one key for him. It's given him new life as well.
Second down and 10 from the 44. Wilson to the outside, another safe pass. Again, that goes to Taylor Gentry. Let's take a look now at our Taco Bell impact players today. Of course, we talked about them off the top, Buck, Skinner and Wilson. They don't make many mistakes.
Well, they also don't do a lot down the field a lot. You know, last week, Raleigh Skinner had a 58-yard pass to Devin Brown. But Russell Wilson, you're going to see a lot of underneath routes. Even when they go vertical, there's always a check down receiver for him to look for. So he both offensive coordinators keep these guys out of tough positions.
It's third down and 4 for NC State. Only 32% on third down conversions this season. A couple of weeks ago, they were 26%. We go back to Andre Brown. He breaks 2 tackles. Bulls forward. It depends on where the mark is. It's going to be very close. Ted Randolph knocked him out of bounds, but he was right at the marker.
And that's where Andre has become more effective, Doug. He had to bounce that play outside. You see guys coming up, but he does such an effective job of breaking through tackles. Some of his defenders or his receivers and everything were not out front blocking for him, so he had one guy right away in the backfield. He gets out of Chip Vaughn's reach and still able to go up and pick up the first down.
So that is a first down. Jamel Eugene is now checked in the game for the Wolfpack, giving Andre Brown a chance for a blow on the sidelines.
You know, this running game for NC State has had 3 straight games of 150 yards on the ground, so they've been very effective the last 3 games.
Wilson with lots of time. That's Eugene over the middle. And the middle of that field is wide open. We saw that against Virginia last week.
Well, it's all verts, so they get all the receivers out. And all you have to do is sneak out the back out of the backfield. And if the linebacker's not paying attention or gets sucked in on something else, it always leaves that receiver right in the middle of the field open. You pick up positive yards. Second and five is always better than second and 10.
That is a big offensive line blocking for Russell Wilson. First two games compared to the last five. Remember that first game, the opener, national TV, ESPN Thursday night, actually got knocked out against South Carolina. What a way to start your collegiate career, but he has bounced back in a big way. Eugene now goes over the left side. They're working that left side, and that gets back to the line of scrimmage. You saw a big Aaron Curry on the bottom of the pile.
Well, you know what Wake Forest does? We've seen them over the last few years, Doug. They'll start off in a base formation on defense, and then Brad Lambert will start making the adjustments, maybe shifting guys around. They want to see what's happening and what NC State is doing offensively to kind of challenge and tweak their defense.
NC State, you see Tom O'Brien sends those tight ends, Taylor Gentry and Richer send in, bring in the play. So now it's third down. They've 2 for 2 so far on third down conversions. Wilson has room to run himself. Waits, has a man wide open. First down, NC State. That's Jay Smith, who made his way behind the defenders, and that's what Wilson does.
Well, Kevin Patterson made a mistake there. The one thing you're taught as a defender, you stay with your guys to the last possible second. Russell Wilson is going to buy himself some time, and you see 86 move out of your screen. Right there, number 10 is in your screen. Kevin Patterson loses Jay Smith, and when he does that, it leaves him wide open, and Russell Wilson does a very nice job of holding on to the very last second.
That goes for 27 yards. He does buy himself plenty of time. Little play action fake. Look out. Dodges trouble into the end zone. It goes and just threw it away. We talked to the coaching staff at NC State about this young quarterback, Russell Wilson. Brad Lambert also said, we did cut-up tape on him, showed our defense, and the first thing they said, looks just like our guy, Riley Skinner, because he'll make you miss and still keep his eyes down the field.
And they're both so calm, Doug. I mean, you don't see him get rattled. I mean, they take their time. Even that play was a prime example. He's in the backfield, knows he has pressure coming because he keeps his back to that backside rush, and when he turns around, he's able just to get wiggle out of it and still go with the play.
Entry is the fullback blocking for Andre Brown. And nowhere.
You know, this is usually the area where Wake Forest tightens up and also brings some pressure. So we'll see those linebackers creeping up, and I wouldn't be surprised if you see the tight end, big Anthony Hill, work this area of the field.
Matt Robinson was on the stop for Wake Forest. Man who's been around this program, a sixth-year senior, granted that extra year of eligibility. And Tom O'Brien and his staff, Dana Bible, said, hey, we recruited him like 10 years ago. He truly is a gray beard.
Doesn't practice much during the week, but continues to make plays.
12th play of this impressive opening drive for the Wolfpack. Over the middle, wide open, touchdown. That's George Bryan. Boy, that was easy.
What did I say? This is the area of the field when, I mean, Dana Bible has grown up in that Sid Gilman type era where you get down here in this red zone, the tight end, you come alive. And big 84, George Bryan, works the middle of the field, cover two, you know the area is open. Right there, you see him coming in, nobody to cover him, he's able to get in there, and you can see him setting it up. Nice play, nice design, nice score for NC State, quickly.
Third touchdown of the season for Bryan. Jankowski on for the extra point. And it's good, and just like that, the Wolfpack takes the opening drive, marches down the field in impressive fashion. Russell Wilson has plenty of time, and it won't get any easier than that. An impressive start for the NC State Wolfpack before a big crowd. NC State marches down the field. Tom O'Brien, graduate of the Naval Academy in his second season, trying to rebuild this NC State program. And Jim Grobe, a graduate of Virginia, spent many years at Air Force, also has a military background. Field never changes that expression. Bradley Pearson will kick off for the Pack. C.J. Washington fields it at the 13. Looking for a gap, cuts it back to the middle, takes a pretty good lick, but gets it out to the 25. Did hang on to that football. They were trying to strip him. That's a 12-yard return. And we'll get our first look at Riley Skinner. We called the Navy game when he threw uncharacteristically four interceptions, Buck, but since then, that was 5 weeks ago, not one pick.
Doug, we talked about it. It had to be an aberration for him the way he played in that game. But I think also the offense changing, using some I formation and spread has really helped him as well.
Brandon Pendergrass to his right. His first 100-yard game a week ago against Virginia in his first carry. Gets 1 yard for Wake Forest. They've done some experimenting on that offensive front. Birdsong is one of the stalwarts. Joe Looney, a true freshman, leaning at center. Pendergrass gets the start. We should see Josh Adams today. Renfret, the hard-blocking fullback, and D.J. Bolden leads the ACC with over 6 receptions per game.
Russell Neenan had a very good game against Virginia with a nose tackle every play lined up against him. Let's see how he does this week.
Skinner now the draw play to Pendergrass. Moves forward past the 30, picks up 4. It'll bring up 3rd down and 5 for the Wolfpack, coming off their best game of the season. Some of these injured players are getting back, including Allen Michael Cash. And Willie Young back in the starting lineup. He's playing inspired football. Michelle at middle linebacker. Nate Irving, he was so good for the first month and then sat out a month. J.C. Neal, he's capable of a big play last week. Returned to kick 89 yards for a touchdown against Duke. 3rd down and 5 in this stadium, which might be the toughest in the ACC when it gets revved up. It's plenty loud right now. Skinner had his man, but getting back for the deflection was Jeremy Gray. Boy, I thought he was beat, by.
I thought he was too. Senior captain Riley put a little bit too much air on it. They come with the zone blitz and back out. You can see the middle of the field covered, but Jeremy Gray with a nice play. If Riley Skinner sticks that ball in there a little better, not as much air, that's a reception.
Good look at Gray. Good recovery for the young man from Opelika, Alabama. First time in 3 weeks, but they haven't scored in their opening drive. Shane Popham, who was so effective against Virginia, filling in for Sam Swank. Another nice punt. And that's fielded by T.J. Graham. A 43-yard punt, 0 on the return. NC State's second possession next. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate, proud sponsor of college football in the 75th Allstate Sugar Bowl. Are you in good hands? Inside the Wendell H. Murphy Football Center, there's Roman Gabriel's bronze statue, the championship trophies, Tom O'Brien. Inside this beautiful stadium as we check in on the field with Melissa Knowles. Melissa?
Thanks, Doug. You know, before the game, Coach O'Brien told me that the main thing he wanted his team to do was to focus on running the ball well. We saw them in that first series. They went out there and they scored. He said that last week, getting that win on the road and snapping a 4-game losing streak really helped build team momentum and morale coming into this game. He's hoping that they will eliminate big plays for Wake Forest, and he's also glad that their team is healthy again. They've had as many as 12 starters out at one point during the season, including Russell Wilson, who missed 5 games. So he's just hoping that some of that momentum will carry over for the rest of this game.
It has been a rash of injuries. I don't think any team in Division I has had more injuries than the Wolfpack. But they have persevered and right now are playing some pretty good football. Wilson lets that go just as he gets hit. He had his man Owen Spencer wide open, and Spencer drops it.
Wow. You don't get those opportunities a whole lot, Doug, and when you do, you have to capitalize. Aaron Curry was coming on the blitz, and as soon as he was getting ready to get to Russell Wilson, watch Russell Wilson at the last second throw this football. But on the other end, you have a defender or a receiver wide open, and Owen has to come up with that. I think he was trying to run with it actually before he caught it.
That hurts.
He's the deep play guy, deep threat. Has come on very well this year with Donald Bowens being out, but you got to come up with that play.
The outside. And another first down. Another beautifully thrown ball by Russell Wilson as it goes for 13 yards.
You know, Doug, I like right away how efficient this offense looks and the ball control and the play faking and everything, and just so many guys getting involved right away. You see Jerron James making that catch there. But what I like already with Russell Wilson, you come and you make a big throw, you don't complete, and you come right back and attack. The rhythm of this offense is going. That's why he leads the ACC in passing efficiency.
That is an impressive number for a first-year quarterback. Jamel Eugene goes nowhere. That's a 2-yard loss. And coming up at 7 Eastern here on the U, it's college football primetime presented by City. UConn taking on Syracuse in the Carrier Dome. And then Delaware State meets Norfolk State. That's 10:30 Eastern. Again, all presented by City on ESPNU and presented in high definition. And remember, ESPNU.com. For all the latest that is college sports, check out ESPNU.com. I wonder if the announcers tonight will be on top of the Carrier Dome like we were a year ago.
I doubt it.
You think Clay has more sense than that?
He does. They do. They both do.
Here's Russell Wilson picking up 5 yards. That'll bring up third down. Stanley Arnault on the stop for the Demon Deacons. A good look at Russell Wilson's eyes. You know, he's only 5'11", and when you stand next to him like we did on the field, I'm not sure he is quite 5'11". Mike Glennon was the superstar quarterback, the blue chip, ranked 4th among quarterbacks that they signed last year in their redshirting. Yeah. He's 6'5 and a half. Physically, he's a little different, but this kid's pretty good.
You know, what it also shows, too, is the faith they had in him. They had a couple other guys, Harrison Beck, Daniel Evans, and then they decided to go with Russell Wilson, and he's really taken this job and done a very good job with that.
And the blitz right up the middle. He somehow wiggled out of trouble. Anthony Hill on the receiving end. I think it's another first down. That goes for 8 yards.
You don't get a chance to see this often where Aaron Curry is going to miss a sack. But he's going to come right in the middle of your screen right there, and he's going to come free and not get there. Aaron Curry is usually the guy watching. He gets by Jamel Eugene and just misses that sack. Right there, you're going to see, you don't see this happen too many times. Mad Dog usually makes the play, but on the other side, Russell Wilson going down the field to Anthony Hill. Very good job of staying poised. I talked about it earlier. Russell Wilson does not get rattled easy. And when he decides to make a decision, he does it.
Back to the ground game. Coming back is Jamel Eugene. For NC State now, 5 for 5 on third down conversions. Just 3 weeks ago, Buck, they were awful on third downs, and that has improved dramatically. The buck stops right here. How about Mr. Curry?
Well, you talk about a guy that just always seems to dial it up when you need to, and this drive already. He was on a blitz, almost got to Russell Wilson, didn't get to him the last time, but you can see here his ability to always make big plays. And his coach says he's a gym rat. He said he loves to just watch film. He knows how to make plays. He understands how the game is played.
Lots of time. And a rare miss by Russell Wilson brings up third down. Some jibber-jawing going on down there between NC State and Wake Forest.
You know, a lot of that's going to happen.
Yeah, a little trash talking. You know, speaking of trash talking, Buck, what we did on the pregame show, and I hope many of our viewers watched the pregame show, we were live in the studio, and we have 10 Wake Forest alums, 10 NC State alums, and Lowell Galindo and Coach Gottfried were there. Was that fun or what?
That was. Good time. They had their internal tailgate, and they come to us, and we help them out a little bit.
And they're watching the game right now back in the ESPNU studios. Wilson just giving himself time. What a fake and what a first down. That is outstanding.
I talked about it on the first drive. You know, they were able to complete or convert on third down. And once again, look at this guy move around. The offensive linemen have to continue to block downfield, but don't go too far down. And he just gets away from folks. And he's been smarter about working down the field since that first game when he got knocked out by South Carolina.
6 for 6 on third down conversions. We're live at Carter-Finley Stadium, Raleigh, North Carolina, home of the Wolfpack, taking on Wake Forest. Doug Bell along with former UCLA Bruin Charles Arbuckle and Melissa Knowles. And total yards so far, favoring the pack. Threw that one to the sidelines. That was a safe pass to Jay Smith. Only Jay could have caught that one.
Well, Alfonso Smith just rode him and didn't allow Jay to get anywhere too close to the ball. But Wake is now starting to bring pressure. They cannot let Russell Wilson sit back there and just stay in that pocket, because he's been able to beat them by doing that. The other thing is they've got to do a better job of covering. A couple of times they've let NC State receivers get behind them.
10th play of this drive. Remember, the opening drive went 12 plays when they scored on that touchdown pass.
See the movement by Wake Forest in their defense. It also makes North Carolina State jump off sides.
That's the first penalty so far.
Dead ball foul. Snap infraction. Offense, 5-yard penalty. Still second down. Player is number 50.
That's Scott McElwee. And I know Scott spent some time talking to Todd Kulis, our producer, before the game, concerned about what they're forecasting for later in this game. Could be some severe weather. Hopefully, it will shy away from us. And our thoughts and prayers out to the people about 30 miles from here. A tornado did touch down in the wee hours of the morning and just devastated that area. And it was just an awful scene on television as we were watching this morning. And there you see the clouds starting to roll in above Carter-Finley Stadium. Wilson with plenty of time. Goes to Andre Brown, who gets knocked out of bounds.
You know, Doug, this offense for NC State just seems to be attacking Wake Forest. You know, we watched Wake Forest last week, and they were so much more in the first quarter going after them. You can just see now they're on their heels. Their defense is really struggling to find an answer, and they're throwing balls out of the backfield, finding guys. Russell Wilson is evading, and they're converting on third down.
Not bad today, huh?
100%. You can't do much better than that.
And Tom O'Brien.
That's your honors classes, right?
And Dana Vival talked to us about that. They knew that was an area of concern, and they've been working hard in that area. Wilson now finally goes down, wrapped up by the old vet, Matt Robinson.
And Aaron Curry right along with him. That time, very good coverage by the secondary. But I said they have to dial it up. Brad Lambert's not waiting back. You'll see this pressure, too many men to block. And Matt Robinson, the old veteran, and Aaron Curry, you can see 59 popping your screen, 42. They work a game. Those defensive linemen crossing up front, crossing up to the offensive linemen.
Bradley Pearson, left-footed punter. He'll kick it off and see if he can angle this somewhere inside the 10-yard line. Alfonso Smith calls for that fair catch at the 9-yard line. So Pearson did his job, a 32-yard punt. Smith forced to call the fair catch, and Wake Forest deep in their own hole, down by a touchdown. We're watching the clouds above Carter-Finley Stadium. You're watching on high definition, crystal clear pictures. Hope you're enjoying it. Our ACC matchup between the Wolfpack trying to win their second straight and end the season on a winning streak to go 6-6 and go to a bowl game. That's what Tom O'Brien told us. Wake Forest hoping that they can play in the ACC championship game for the second time in the last 3 years. Riley Skinner with time. That's batted down.
I think Keith Willis was the one that knocked that down.
Big number 94, one of the healthy players that's played all year for NC State.
That's big 94 right there. Able to get his hand up.
Second down now for Riley Skinner. And Pendergrass gets a lot of those yards on his own. He gets stopped by Robbie Leonard after a gain of 2. Last week against Virginia, Pendergrass, it was his coming out party, Buck.
Yeah, you know, he had been playing behind Josh Adams. And when Josh went down, he got an opportunity, and they did a very good job at offensive line of blocking out front, giving him an opportunity to run. You see the power game right there. Renfret, Joe Looney to score that touchdown. But ever since they've gone to the I formation, sprinkled in with the spread, this Wake Forest team has taken off in the run game.
Third down and 8. And again, this big crowd making lots of noise. Skinner with lots of time over the middle, wide open. First down to DJ Bolden. Out to the 39-yard line. That goes for a smooth 25 yards.
Nice job by Riley Skinner also of not looking to where he was going to go. You know he wanted to try to attack the middle of the field. DJ Bolden is his go-to guy. Had 55 catches coming into today's ball game. But the middle of the field is open. You see he works to the left and then comes back to the middle in that cover two area. Riley Skinner does a very good job of that. Nate Irvin trying to get back was sucked up just enough to throw it in between those two deep safeties.
So a new set of downs. Ben Wooster in motion now. The tight end back in the lineup for the second straight week. Skinner to the outside. This is Chip Brinkman.
It's like a fastball, a little high. Chip couldn't hold on to that one.
He rifled it.
He didn't get a lot of credit for his arm strength, Riley Skinner, but that ball came out hot. It wasn't highly recruited out of Jacksonville, Florida. You know, they really were looking at John Russell, the defensive tackle, who's put on about 30 pounds now starting. Riley Skinner was pretty much their, you know, one of those guys late to come. But he's been very effective for this Wake Forest ball club.
Second down and 10. That's Bolden in motion. He takes the hand off and then throws a pass to a wide open receiver. That's going to be a touchdown to Marshall Williams. Totally fooled NC State. That goes for 64 yards.
You know, Doug, they talked about trying to get plays in their playbook where they can get down the field. Steve Lebotsky, the offensive coordinator, and we asked him, would you come up with something this week? And sure enough, here it goes. This orbit screen of the thing that they like to do here, but down the field, everyone gets sucked up. They like that long reverse that they handed off and let him come around all the way around on that reverse, and that time it was set up perfectly. And DJ Bolden showing off the arm.
Shane Popham connects on the extra point, filling in for the All-American Sam Swank and doing a nice job. And DJ Bolden said, I like throwing that football. I like catching him, but it's awful fun to throw it. That was a beautiful play. That's just perfection.
Well, they do a very good job of running those plays where you come across the formation and you have to hold horizontally. But that time they threw a little flavor into it with the vertical route by Marshall Williams. He kind of stalks DeAndre Morgan and then works down the field and is open for six.
The senior from Pahokee, Florida. Something tells me he's going to be talking about that for a while.
He's going to call Anquan and say, hey, did you see that? Did you see my arm? Big brother, did you see it?
That was a five-play, 91-yard drive. Let's check in with Melissa down in the field.
Guys, something they're known for in Pahokee is running from rabbits. Everybody talks about it. Even Alfonso Smith talks about it because he's also from Pahokee. Apparently, they have lots of sugarcane stalks, and when the farmers burn those sugarcane stalks, getting ready for the harvest for the next season, rabbits run around. And in order for the guys to get in shape and to learn to run really fast, they chase the rabbits. So maybe that's where he learned that.
Legend has it, Melissa, you're right.
Maybe he was throwing some rabbits. Muck City is what they like to call it down there.
Popham, the squib kick. It fools T.J. Graham. Look out for Graham, though. Boy, don't let him get in open space, and they don't as they wrestle him down at the 26. That's an 11-yard return. Let's check in with Lo Galindo in the Sports Center U studio.
Guys, thank you so much. South Carolina on the road at the Swamp, taking on the Florida Gators, and Chris Smelly wants this one back. He ain't getting it back, though, because that's Brandon Spikes, pick six. Gators romping at least early, 7-0.
Chris Smelly, the young man from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, with a big mistake in that defense for the Gators. You see what they've done. South Carolina has never won in Gainesville. Back to the ground game. There's Andre Brown picking up 9 yards. And well, we've seen Andre Brown a lot over the last 3 years, Buck, and he's just gotten better and better each and every year.
You know, you look at the stats also. His longest carry this year is 14 yards. But when you watch him on film, you see a lot of yards after contact. Multiple contacts. I mean, he gets hit and just keeps his leg drive going. He's put on some good solid weight. He's about 230 pounds, and if he stays healthy, which they're hoping he can do, he's going to really give them something to think about these last few weeks in the ACC play.
Second down and about a half a yard. They have to fight to get that half yard. In fact, I don't think Andre Brown has it. No gain, so it'll bring up third down.
Good defensive play, John Russell. You talked about him and Riley Skinner going to the same school down in Jacksonville, the ball school. See, they didn't teach him this in school, though. His helmet's going to get taken off. You know, Curtis Crouch just trying to block him and just takes his helmet off. Hey, you got to make the play still. John doesn't care. He's still trying to fight. Scrap.
That's the end of the first quarter. Big John Russell lost his helmet, but put up a nice stand. It'll be third and short as we start the second quarter. See the sunny skies? That was earlier today. It's not sunny any longer. Got a tie ball game. Wake Forest, NC State. We start the second quarter in Raleigh, North Carolina, all tied up. It's third and about a half a yard. Russell Wilson under center, the talented freshman quarterback, has put on a show so far. And there's the first down to Andre Brown. Allstate presents Bergwood on location. It's the 102nd meeting in this series, and NC State leads by a whopping number. It is the longest running series for the Wolfpack. And remember, you can tailgate with Bergwood at bergwood.net. And of all the places we travel in the ACC, the tailgating here, outstanding. Might be the best. I don't want to say the best, but the folks can really cook up a good meal for you. That's batted down by Matt Robinson. Speaking of this series, going back to 2006, one of the best games in the series. How about October 14th? Look at that hard nose running. And NC State went on top. And that was no good. And then in the end, Evans fires, and it's picked off. Another interception, and Wake Forest hangs on. Jim Groves' magical season, and they won a close one here in Raleigh. There's another penalty.
Jake Vermiglio looked like he was moving a little bit early. The only other thing is they could call him Anthony Davis.
Full start. Offense, number 70. Remains second down.
Vermiglio moved into the starting lineup because of injury a year ago and really played well. We saw him move into that lineup against Chris Long in Virginia. And I thought he did a pretty good job a year ago in that game that we call.
Gave a good account of himself. Look at the total plays, though. But the one for Wake Forest was huge. Touchdown. NC State has controlled the clock, but they got stopped on the third down conversion on the last drive as they were moving down the field.
Wilson has seven completions to seven different receivers. Stops, goes deep. Defenders turned around and it is caught. Down to the 17, that's Owen Spencer. Dropped one in the first quarter, made a nice catch that time, and no, he does not catch it. That's two drops now for Spencer. Spencer's jersey got pulled off his shoulder pads and he was complaining about it.
Chip Vaughn was covering him. And once again, nice deep throw. But Chip Vaughn is holding on to him right there. You see him grabbing him by his waist. The official's looking up at the ball. Spencer kind of trips down right before the ball gets to him and loses it. That's another drop. They've had two times to go to him deep, and he's their deep threat, 20 yards per catch.
That was the blitz by Aaron Curry, and he might have jumped the gun just a bit trying to anticipate the snap.
Delay of game. Offense.
Ooh, it goes against the Wolfpack.
5 yards. Remains third down.
And you hear the wind blowing into Scott McAwee's mic, and the wind is now starting to pick up, Buck.
Yeah, Doug. Two plays back-to-back also. And that ball that Russell Wilson threw, mind you, was into the wind. Still had enough air on it. Owen Spencer couldn't come up with it. Delay of game penalty. Seems like every time you have those kind of plays, it compounds. Time of possession clearly in North Carolina State's favor, even though it's a tie score here.
Third down and 20. This is what plagued NC State earlier this season, these third and longs.
Wilson will buy himself time. We've seen that. And he buys himself an eternity and finally just throws it out of bounds as Alfonso Smith has enough of that.
Very good coverage down the field, but also a very smart heads-up play by Russell Wilson. You know, once again, where you know you're going to look down the field, you're going to try to find somebody that clearly have picked everything up. Makes a couple of more looks. Can't figure out where he's going. Throw the ball out of bounds. Good play by Russell Wilson. Good coverage by Wake Forest.
Bradley Pearson on for another punt now for the Pack. 32 yards on his first kick. Ooh, that was almost blocked. Packer flag is down. They did not get the ball. They got the kicker. I don't think it'll be it's roughing the kicker. Yep.
They really tried to go after it. Now Alfonso Smith trying to aggressively get that block, and in doing so, takes the kicker completely out.
No foul. Roughing the kicker. Defense, number two. That's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
Alfonso Smith has one block on the year. So a big, big play for North Carolina State to keep the ball.
And then the one thing I've noticed, Buck, is we've watched a lot of tape. When Wake Forest goes into that blocking mode, Alfonso Smith, instead of returning the punt, he lines up on the outside and Bolden goes back.
Yep.
You know,
it gives him a heads up what's coming,
yeah.
But still, he's almost able to get there. And the reason why, with the teams now just having three backs in the backfield and no gunners, there's no extra protection, so you can almost get to the block.
So NC State gets a first down thanks to that roughing the kicker, and Wilson has a wide open receiver who drops it again. Owen Spencer just cannot hang on today. Kevin Patterson laid some leather on him. Tough day for Owen so far.
Yeah, sometimes you have these kind of days, Doug, and the key is Russell Wilson's going to keep going to him. Wide open in this area, and in cover two situations, you're usually going to be in between the corner and the safety. Good job by Patterson of coming over and delivering the lick. But Owen Spencer should have brought that one down as well. And then it gets in your head. You just start thinking, get over to the sideline, throw me some passes, whoever the backup quarterback is, let me get back focused. It happens to all receivers.
You know, Eugene over the right side. And he jumped up into the air and took a lick from Stanley Arnault, picks up two. You don't want to leave your feet with Arnault out there. He's a ball hawker. He'll knock it out of there.
He'll come over and stick you. You know, Stanley Arnault and Aaron Curry are really close. They watch a lot of film together. And I can remember when John Abadi decided to go out early and test his market in the draft, a lot of folks at Wake Forest were concerned. But Stanley Arnault has just really played well. You can see those guys, a number of starts they have, the tackles. And it's good at the linebacker position, the combination of guys that you know what Aaron Curry does well, and you also know that Stanley Arnault is going to man the middle well.
Ninth play of this drive, 7-9 on third down. Wilson has all day and just threw it wide of Jamel Eugene.
Doug, I was focusing on that play. Stanley Arnault tackled Jamel Eugene. And then when he saw Russell Wilson come open, he went after him. That's why Jamel Eugene was open. I mean, he literally tackled Jamel Eugene.
This is a veteran defense for Wake Forest, made up of many fifth-year seniors. In the case of Matt Robinson, a sixth-year senior. You can't fool him. I mean, you really just have to go at him and out-physical Wake Forest. So far, NC State has done a good job, but again, Pearson will have to punt again. Now Bolden calls for the fair catch and falls backwards. It'll be marked at the 9-yard line. That is a 52-yard boot by Bradley Pearson. Tied up in Raleigh, 7-7. Wake Forest 24th in the country. And knowing they need help, they do not control their own destiny. And for Tom O'Brien, I mentioned to him this week, I said, Coach, you could play spoiler in your last three games. And he said, spoiler? Because if we win out, we're going to a bowl game. You don't want to hear anything about spoiler. And I enjoy talking to him. I must say, he's one of those guys, you want to be
Gotta be alert.
The old military man from the Naval Academy.
With a dry wit.
You have to be careful around Coach. We'll get after you if you're careless with a question. We'll take a look inside his office, the coach's crib, right after this. Skinner, Pendergrass, the biggest hole so far, but Pendergrass and his longest run goes for 8 yards. Coach O'Brien led us in the office yesterday. It's a beautiful office which overlooks the stadium. And on his shelf, so many mementos. There you see the Army-Navy game from 1970. He played in that game. Of course, he spent so many years with George Welsh at Virginia. See Sea Warfare, the book on the shelf. And of course, always the weather map. The Weather Channel is on in the coach's office. And he was concerned about the weather today, as we are right now, because Pendergrass goes forward close to a first down. Buck, earlier today when we were outside, I mean, it was warm. It was about 78 degrees, and right now it's cooling off, and usually when that cold air hits the warm air, you get some bad weather. That's the forecast here in about a half hour. We're hoping that it bypasses us to the east, but we'll see. Let's find out more about this weather with Melissa down in the field. Melissa, how is the wind down there?
You know, the wind gusts have picked up. When we first came out here, I think it was about 30 miles per hour. Every now and then you'll get a huge wind gust. And just a second ago, all the cheerleader signs flew into the stands. That just shows you how hard the wind is gusting.
Look out for those signs. That can be hazardous to your health. Bolden on the outside. That's a play that we see all the time with Wake Forest. That goes for 9 yards. Skinner really does a nice job throwing that pass.
He does. And also, DJ Bolden, strong enough to break that initial tackle. You know, you get the play fake, you get the defense going one way, and it puts a one-on-one situation. Guys trying to work themselves out. The linebacker right there, Robbie Leonard, finally comes over. But DJ Bolden at 6 foot, 220 pounds, is very physical as a receiver.
Second down and 1 yard to go for another first down for the Demon Deacons. They go to the fullback. Falls forward, that's Belton on forward. A lot of basketball coming up on ESPNU. Three games from the O'Reilly Auto Parts CBE Classic. First at 2:15 Eastern tomorrow. It's the Bradley Braves against the Gators down in Gainesville. Then Lemoyne opens against Syracuse. And University of Missouri, Kansas City taking on the Jayhawks. A triple header tomorrow on ESPNU.
Talked a lot about,
tell you what, ESPNU right now. If you like college hoops, you want to get a taste of some of these big teams, how they look early on, turn on to ESPNU. Skinner with time to the outside. Again, that's Rich Belton. Nice catch. Robbie Leonard on the stop. I like Belton. We saw him last week, the senior from Chapel Hill against Virginia, and he moves pretty well for a big man.
He does. He's also a very good runner in between the tackles. The one guy, though, we haven't really talked a whole lot about is Nate Irvin. You know, he's a key on that weak side linebacker position, and here he is, you know, just right there on the screen. He's a guy that makes a lot of plays.
Difference maker, and here he comes on the blitz. They picked him up. Riley Skinner saw the blitz. That's just an experienced quarterback.
Yeah. Yes, he was able to just get by just enough. You talk about Nate Irvin, you can tell Mike Archer, he'll dial it up. He'll dial up the pressure, the defensive coordinator. And he was just saying, it's, you know, it's tough against Riley Skinner because he's so good at avoiding rush, and he just seen so many plays and understands.
Those are the players out for the season for the Wolfpack. Donald Bowen's big difference maker, Javon Walker on defense. Now third down and 4. Skinner to the outside. Read that perfectly to Marshall Williams. They blitzed on the outside, but they picked it up.
Well, and wherever they come from, Doug, you see Riley Skinner usually doing a very good job of throwing it where they vacate. So you see that side, they're coming with the blitz. He knows, okay, my hot read is right there. He's able to get it to him. Coverage over the top, can't get there quite quickly enough. So he knows right away, if they come with the zone blitz, I know where my receiver is. I get it to him. He can make some yards and a first down.
Marshall Williams, one of those players that Coach Lobotsky was telling us gets better as the game goes on. Warms up. Here he is in the slot. Doing a nice job. And in that crease, J.C. Neal on the tackle for the Wolfpack.
Alan Michael Cash came over the top and may have put a lick on him. We're talking about a bigger guy, 285 pounds, and Marshall Williams, only 195 out of Durham, North Carolina, took a shot. But Doug, he also said he wanted to get him more touches. Mm-hmm. He said, we really got to get the ball in his hands. He's so effective. He's our deep threat guy. Vertically, we want to do it. They did that already. And now we saw in this drive two receptions already.
And he's on the sidelines, Buck. You're right. He got shaken up on that last hit. Took the helmet off. Riley Skinner again. Good numbers early on. And the reverse to Devin Brown. One's running to...
Nate Irving is in there.
Big Nate.
along with Alan Michael Cash. He's a difference maker. Alan Michael Cash is a guy that really has made a difference coming back from injury. Let's look back at a play ago when Marshall Williams there. This is usually incoming where the defender gets hurt by his own man, but right here, he holds him up. Ooh. And boom, that's the old hold him up move. Hold him up, guy. Let me come in. Bam! And hit it.
It's a
playground move, guy.
Yeah, they don't do that, do they?
Yeah, they do.
Absolutely, they do. 10th play of this drive for Wake Forest. Remember, started back inside their 10-yard line. Skinner over the middle. Almost intercepted. Ben Wooster was wide open, but he just threw it too high.
Raleigh's arm today, Doug, he threw a fastball again. He had Ben over the middle of the field, and he wanted to make sure he got it there. Watch how quick this is slow motion, and still look how fast that ball is coming. He dialed up his fastball today. It was 85 last week. I think it's about 92 this week.
That was Clem Johnson playing center field and almost fell right into his mitts. Two out of three now on third downs for the Demon Deacons wearing those white road jerseys. Crowd does get awful loud at Carter-Finley Stadium. Pressure. And it is picked off. Here comes the Wolfpack, Jeremy Gray. Pendergrass trying to wrestle him down. Finally, he does.
Now, I'll blame a little bit of that on the receiver, Marshall Williams, who probably shouldn't have been back in the game. Good play by Jeremy Gray. But Marshall Williams is the receiver that Riley Skinner is looking for. You see, he's ridden out of bounds. And good play by Jeremy Gray of also coverage and then coming over. And watch this hit right here by Wooster. Wooster gets taken out right there by Jamal Simmons. But Jeremy Gray, good coverage. And then I think J.C. Neal was coming over Clem Johnson to tip that ball up.
So that's Skinner's first interception in 142 passes, Buck. That breaks his string. To the outside is Jarvis Williams. Again, you have to be impressed with this young quarterback, Russell Wilson, who also plays on the NC State baseball team. And Tom O'Brien told him, I don't mind you playing baseball. If you're going to be a quarterback, though, you can't miss any practice in spring.
And he didn't miss any.
And he didn't miss any.
And he was there for every baseball practice as well as spring football practice.
In fact, the spring game played the whole game and then hustled over and played in the afternoon baseball game. You stay quite busy when you're the quarterback also trying to play baseball. And again, it's Jarvis Williams on the outside. They're working that left side.
They really are, Doug. And the one rule that has helped guys play multiple sports is the 20-hour rule in football. It allows you to play other sports, but it also allows you to be a guy like this who can play baseball very well, but come out here and sling this rock around. Big blocking right there out in front, giving him a chance to go down the field.
His baseball numbers, not bad. A 296 average, had those two home runs. Appeared in 32 games for the Wolfpack baseball team. Back to the ground is Andre Brown. Andre Brown, here's a senior, has yet to go to a bowl game. And Tom O'Brien says, hey, if we went out, we go to a bowl game. There's a young man who believes him. You know, he says, I want to go to a bowl. And if the coach says we win four in a row, by golly, we're going to win four in a row, and it's fun to talk to a kid like that.
Yeah, and Doug, you also have to think about Tony Baker, who is going to play an integral role in this team and what he was going to bring to the table. He's been out along on that list of guys that have been hurt. He and Andre Brown were an awful good tandem a few years ago.
Wilson with loads of time. Rifles that in there for another first down. And that's Owen Spencer, his first catch of the game. And look at the crowd. That goes for 12 yards, and even Owen's clapping.
Hey, he's got to be happy, finally getting that out. But you know what? I like what the quarterback has done. He's going to keep throwing to him. Good job. You see Stanley Arnold taking out Chip Vaughn on that play. Those are the easier catches. He's been running away from the ball. That time he turns to it, hits him right between the one and the three.
One thing I've noticed about Russell Wilson, he is so accurate.
I mean,
he doesn't miss by much. There's another flag that'll go against the Wolfpack. That'll be their third penalty. Let's check in with a tailgate party back in the ESPNU studios.
Guys, thank you so much. I'm standing by with Kelly, who has a question about Wake Forest.
I do. I feel like it's normally our defense that is our winning spot. We've got a lot of good players on our defense, but they're not showing up. We're wondering what's going on with defense. Do you know anything about what's going on?
They're playing on their heels, Lowell. I think this North Carolina State team has come out and really been aggressive in attacking them, and that's been the biggest problem. You know, and when they dialed up the blitzes, they haven't gotten there, and that's one of the things they have to do and continue to get after this North Carolina State offense.
Wilson throws it out of bounds.
And get off the field on third down. That was the one thing. They were 6-for-6 in that early stretch. And that's played a big difference. It's tough for those defensive linemen to keep coming and keep coming. And each time you think, oh, I'm going to get a breather, because it doesn't happen for them. You know, the Alfonso Smith, the running into the kicker, that hurt them. Those things keep your guys out there too long. And when they're out there, this offense can tend to attack you.
Veteran defense, which has virtually seen it all over the years, Russell Wilson. Another fine start for the young man who leads the ACC in passing efficiency. 55% completion percentage. He's going to take off, show a little speed, looking for a block. And he gets it and just slides down after a 24-yard scamper. First time we've seen him run with the football.
But I think he recognized that there was going to be an opening in the middle of the field. He saw this happening. You can see him looking downfield, but then he wants to tuck it. And he's not looking to tuck and throw, but tuck and run. Then he becomes the field general. Block for me. Block for me, please, so I can get down the field and get away from Aaron Kerr. Nice play by Russell Wilson.
I know Brad Lambert, the defensive coordinator for the Demon Deacons, doesn't blitz too much, but I think he's going to have to shake things up here a bit, put a little pressure on the quarterback. That's Eugene getting wrapped up. Dana Bible, the outstanding offensive coordinator, quarterbacks coach for NC State, says where he is now compared to the beginning of the season is night and day. Bottom line, you have to live it, you have to do it, and he has certainly grown from it.
And I respect Dana Bible a lot, because he had Matt Ryan at Boston College. And, you know, a few years ago and doing one of their games when he and Tom O'Brien were there, we talked about how good Matt Ryan was then. He said he was going to be a great player. And then talking about Russell Wilson, just his maturity as a young quarterback and what he's able to do. Different from Matt Ryan, but still able to manage a game very, very well.
Eighth play of the drive. Wilson. Out sprints Curry to the sidelines. He picks up 7, and this is an exciting young player that is coming into his own.
He just stays so calm, Doug. I mean, we talk about Riley Skinner being able to do that, but you got Aaron Curry chasing you, and then you fake the pass, and you still get positive yards. Put yourself in third and short, which is much easier to convert, and this is a long drive. You see guys for Wake Forest, hands on their hips, they're getting a little tired. The offense now feels like they can attack them and score going into halftime.
7 out of 10, third down conversions. At one point, they were 6 out of 6. Chess match between Dana Bible and Brad Lambert. And again, it's another good move for NC State as he picks up 5 and another first down.
Doug, I love that play, because you play fake to Andre Brown. He's your initial receiver. And then if he doesn't have it, you boot out. And they do a lot of this. Dana Bible's doing a lot of boot outs. And that was the one thing he and Tom O'Brien talked about. We had to learn what Russell's strengths were. And I think that's the toughest thing with coaches. You so often hear him talk about my system. Well, the players make your system. And Jim Grobe is a prime example of that, the things they've done on the offensive side. But he's worried now, can his defense come up with a stop?
Taylor Gentry is wide to the right, and Andre Brown is wide left over the middle, and that was knocked down by Stanley Arnaud.
Russell wants that pass back. You know why? If he puts air on that one, that's a touchdown. The middle of your field, hold it right there. Look at all of that opening right there in the field. But he tries to stick it in right where Stanley Arnaud is, you see? And if he puts the air on it, that's six. And he wants that back. It's one of those decisions you have to make as a quarterback. I can't fault him. He sees that on the field so much quicker than we do up here. We can second guess it. But a very good job by Stanley Arnaud, who has struggled sometimes in coverage. Probably could have had a pick if he couldn't got there a little early.
11th play of the drive. Remember, the opening drive went for 12 plays. They are churning up the time and the yards. That gets inside the 5-yard line. He is spreading the ball around. Well, this has been just so impressive.
That's the struggle. You say, why is Wake Forest struggling? Well, they don't know where it's coming. You got Jamel Eugene. You got Andre Brown. You have all these different receiver weapons. And Andre Brown is very effective after the catch. He has 20 receptions on the year. So you know, out of the backfield, you have to cover. And that's usually a mismatch. A linebacker on a running back, you usually win that running back battle.
And there's another first down. Now, their drive so far, Buck, 12 plays in the opening drive went for a touchdown, then 11 plays. Then they had a 9-play drive, and now this will be the 13th play in this drive. That's when you're on offense, that's what you want to do.
Well, and that's been best for their defense, keeping their defense off the field. That Wake Forest offense, which was so effective in the first half last week, has not had the ball enough to really do anything with it.
Inside a minute 45 now in the second quarter, and a timeout for Wake Forest. You want to come to the sidelines, regroup, Brad Lambert and company, and talk about this NC State attack, which right now is on the march. 1:42 to play, second quarter, all tied up. Remember, tonight, more football action on ESPNU. It's UConn and Syracuse, 7 Eastern from the Carrier Dome in the Delaware State, Norfolk State, all part of college football primetime presented by City on ESPNU. A year ago, we were in the Carrier Dome, and actually on top of the Carrier Dome, shooting our open. There's Todd Kulis, our producer. He was the only one brave enough to get up there. Only kidding. Several
I'm
members
holding
of our
on
crew.
To the pole. I'm by the pole.
I was wondering if Clay Matvick and David Diaz Infante, tonight's crew, would get on top of there, huh?
No.
It was an unusual vantage point. There it is, a touchdown. Russell Wilson, what a great vantage point he had. And it was just wide open lane right up the gut.
Very good job also, Doug, and a key block. This offensive line did an outstanding job on that drive. But let's take a look at Jamel Eugene and his block inside here. And he eliminates that. That's why you're able to walk into the end zone. And it's against Stanley Arnaud, a much bigger defender. Watch, boom, good block. And knocked Arnaud back. Held him a little bit. But very good block, one-on-one matchup, offensive line doing the rest. That's why Russell Wilson went in for 6.
Tukowski on for the extra point. Wolfpack back on top. And the extra point is good. We're looking for a flag because there was all sorts of movement, but I don't see anything on the field. So it's 14-7.
Look at Russell Wilson waiting for that block, and it comes at the perfect time. The offensive line, you can't give them enough kudos on that last drive because they protected, they ran the ball well, and then that last finishing drive is a much smaller man than Jamel Eugene, who's also, he's very strong now, against Stanley Arnaud, who's weighing in at about 240 pounds.
Tom O'Brien came in when he took over this program 2 years ago, and he said, I want to dominate this state. There's enough good talent in this state to build a solid program. 57 players currently on the roster from the state of North Carolina. For Jim Grobe, he has a lot of Floridians on his roster, and Tom O'Brien trying to get rid or at least change the look of the team because he had a bunch of Floridians from Chuck Amato's team.
Yeah, and I think some of that, too, is just what your influences are. And I think they like the Floridian kids to a certain degree, but they just felt like North Carolina, they had two of the fastest growing counties in the country here in this state. And they felt like, we need to get guys, it's NC State, it's North Carolina State. Why not get the kids that are here that have grown up understanding what our traditions are, and they started to do that. Now, don't get away from Wake Forest. They have a lot of North Carolina kids as well. Duke is also trying to do that. And then right up the road, who's playing very well, North Carolina. So all of them are battling now for those top prospects not to go to Clemson, not to go to Georgia, not to get away. They want to keep those North Carolina kids here at home.
It is interesting. The four programs in the ACC from this state are all on the upswing.
Yeah, they
certainly are. Wake Forest is on the major upswing because they've been pretty good for several years now. But when you look at NC State, what they have, what's coming, obviously what Butch Davis is doing and what David Cutcliffe is trying to do, it's pretty neat to see what's happening here.
The balance of power could be right in the middle of the ACC with these teams in North Carolina if they continue to improve and get better.
Bradley Pearson. Into his back. Sends Devin Brown into the end zone. Took that Alfonso Smith. Scoots out. And that was Brown. He gets out to the 31. That's where Wake Forest will take over. They haven't had the ball much. Let's see what they can do with it when we come back. NC State playing keep away from Wake Forest as they lead 14-7. Coming up at halftime on SportsCenter U, it's Lo Galindo and Mike Gottfried. Number four, the Gators are taking a bite out of South Carolina. The Tar Heels, the Basketball Heels, tip off. And we'll have more from our ESPNU tailgate party. If you watched it earlier, Coach Gottfried was schooling Lowell in foosball. The coach can flat out play foosball.
Lowell's not an athlete.
Almost intercepted again. Remember Skinner's long streak of 142 passes without a pick came to an end on the last drive. Jeremy Gray knocked that down.
North Carolina State defense is dialing it up, and now, you know, that's that sink coverage. Jeremy Gray knows the ball has to go over his head. He works his area first and gets back and almost comes up with a nice play again.
Time of possession lopsided in the favor of NC State. Skinner wide open as Brinkman, he's knocked out of bounds. And again, we're seeing two outstanding quarterbacks with great field vision. That goes for 33 yards.
Well, the offensive line could probably be called for holding there, but Riley Skinner able to get away and stay alive. And Chip Brinkman knows he's usually the possession guy, but stays open and gets an opening. And find your quarterback. As your receiver, you're always taught, make sure you show yourself so he can connect with you.
Skinner to the outside, Andrew Parker. He is the freshman tight end who filled in admirably for Ben Wooster, who's out with a hamstring and now doesn't get as much playing time. But as Wooster, with Wooster and Parker coming back next year, they have a pretty good tight end tandem.
They really do. Both of those guys have shown they can catch the football and block on the edges. Wake has to really rush here and get some momentum going into the half.
Inside a minute. That's Bolden over the middle. He gets thrown down by Nate Irving.
See, the biggest problem with these routes, Doug, is that, you know, you can just play on top of it. You see here, look what's at stake.
Wake needs a victory to stay on top. Florida State plays Boston College tonight without five of their receivers who were suspended after that brawl earlier this week in the student union on campus. Skinner will keep it himself, gets the first down. Looking for more as he scampers out of bounds at the 15. That stops the clock just inside 19 seconds as he goes for 19 yards on the ground.
You talk about a veteran quarterback understanding what the situations are. If they're playing and they don't cover you, you go ahead on up the field and you pick up yards. Now you give yourself a couple of chances to go at the end zone. And that's the one thing. Remember, Sam Swank has not been able to kick, so Shane Popham becomes the guy. Swank has been able to kick Nerf balls, but not able to kick any footballs this week.
Skinner dumps it off. Inside the 10 it goes. That's Cameron Ford. He gets tripped up by DeAndre Morgan. And quickly Wake Forest calls timeout. Nine seconds remain in the second quarter.
Riley Skinner finding his receiver. Cameron Parker chips on the end and then sneaks out of the backfield. Usually the linebackers lose you on that kind of play. And Skinner knows he's available. Then he tries to pick up yards after the catch. He's another impressive young guy. Freshman out of Anderson, South Carolina. Redshirt freshman.
For Wake Forest. They have Boston College and Vandy. This is their last home game, their last road game. And the next one could be their final conference game. If they win out and get help, they will be in the ACC championship. They need Maryland to lose.
You know, Doug, the Atlantic Coast Conference has to be called the absolutely crazy conference, because every week this year we ask coaches, have you ever seen anything like this? No. It's unequivocal. Every coach has been, they've coached everywhere. Steve Lebotsky, offensive coordinator, you know, we talked to him about it. He's like, I don't know. I can't quite figure this out. We don't even try to bring it up with the kids. There's so many variables. If we just keep winning, that ensures us an opportunity.
Second down and two. They have one timeout remaining. Perhaps time for two plays into the end zone. Skinner quickly three steps over the middle, and that's going to be a touchdown. They left the middle wide open, and DJ Bolden found a groove and the touchdown.
Well, usually you see the tight ends that can get over the middle of the field, but DJ Bolden just as strong at 6 foot 220. And I think all their receivers are going to go and get 1 yard either in the end zone or 1 yard before the end zone. They work that flood route where they have three guys going. It opens that area in the zone, and DJ Bolden with six.
Shane Popham on for the extra point. And we're all tied up in Raleigh. The lights are shining bright because the skies have turned dark. But it's illuminated a playing surface where two teams are putting on quite a show. You see the clouds now as a front is moving in. Radar is not looking promising for the second half, but we will keep you posted.
Doug, that was a very impressive drive. Before the drive started, North Carolina State had 44 plays they had run. Wake had only run 19 plays in this first half.
Well, the answer is, you look at the Wake Forest flag really blowing in that breeze. That was a quick drive. 7 plays, 68 yards, just took a minute 26. And that's the thing about the NC State defense. They have shown improvement a week ago against Duke. They don't tackle particularly well.
Yes, that's true.
In the middle there, was wide open.
When you play cover two, that's going to happen sometimes. That's where your vulnerability is. And I think that's the one area you can't do anything about the system of the defense. But what you have to do is stop the receiver from getting in those open spaces. And Riley Skinner is so efficient at finding where you're least able to cover his guys.
So Popham with a squib. DJ Graham did not get this one. He'll be a blocker. To the outside is Clem Johnson. And Johnson got the crowd kind of excited as he runs out the clock. 22 on the return. It has been an entertaining first half. What else would you expect? It's ACC football. We're tied at 14. Now let's join Lowell Galindo, Coach Gottfried, and our big party in the Sports Center U studio.
That is how we do it. Welcome into the Sports Center U Halftime Report. You can't really hear me right now because I'm surrounded by alumni from Wake Forest and North Carolina State. They're having a good time. And, you know, I got to point this out. Before the game started, Coach Mike Gottfried, what did he call for, guys?
A tie.
And right now, we got a game tied at 14. Before we go into the ACC and other stuff like that, we got to start in the Southeastern Conference. And to do that, we go down to the Swamp. It is South Carolina taking on the Florida Gators. There's the ball, Coach. But early on, Chris Melly wants this one back. He's not going to get it back because Brandon Spikes takes it to the house. Russell Wilson would never do that.
Never. He's a beast.
He is a beast. I'll tell you who else is a beast. This man right there, Percy Harvin. Snapping up tackles, 26 yards for the score. Gators up by 14-0. I don't know. What are they thinking here, guys? Oh. Yeah, Deion LeCorn laterals to Chris Hell. James Smith recovers, doesn't get the touchdown. The Gators would get that touchdown. Right now, it's 28-0. The Florida Gators looking to run away with this game. Now, we go to Coach Mike Gottfried. And, Coach, before this game, we talked about this. You said that Florida would get off to that hot start. From here, What does South Carolina even have to do to try to get back into this game?
South Carolina, 3 turnovers in the first quarter, so Florida's really got things going.
Yeah, it doesn't look good for the Florida Gators at all.
No.
Well, we have some fan participation now. We have Mark. Give us your background, first off, in North Carolina State. When did you graduate? What's your major in?
I graduated in 06 in undergrad and 08 in grad school, so I'm a seasoned veteran from NC State.
Are you a seasoned veteran with the highlights, though? We're about to find out. Let's go with the highlights. It's Georgia and Auburn. Take it away, Mark.
All right, we got Georgia at Auburn. Auburn taking the field against the Bulldogs. We got 1st and 10 right here. Cody Burns completes a pass to Mario Fanning. Takes it 52 yards to the house.
He's going.
And he's going, and he's going. Auburn misses the field goal. Maintains the lead 6-0. Right here, 3rd and 1 for Auburn. Cody Burns again to Mario Fanning. Dodges a couple tackles. Takes it to the house again. 35-yard touchdown. Auburn leads 13-10.
It's easy.
Georgia, 2nd and 9, 4th quarter. Matthew Stafford hits A.J. Green, 17-yard touchdown. Georgia on top, 17-13. Down here at the end of the game, 4th and 1. Auburn's got to hit a touchdown. They're down 4. Burns pass comes up short, incomplete. Georgia holds on, takes the win.
And you know what that means? That means that Auburn, its first 6-loss season since 1999. Coming up, we're going to talk more about the ACC. We got North Carolina, Maryland, and also some Carolina basketball, I'm sure. Oh, why are you booing? Come on, it's equal opportunity
football
here at
season.
SportsCenter U. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Welcome back to the SportsCenter. You have to, you put a stick mic in my house. You know, I got to do a little serenading here. If I say UNC, what do you guys say? All right, and did I hear a vomit back here?
It makes them want to vomit.
They want to vomit. Well, dilemma for North Carolina fans, because today, 3:30, the football team kicks off their game. But at 4 o'clock over at the Dean Dome, the number one basketball team in the land, North Carolina, taking on Pitt. What about those dance moves? You know, Coach Godfrey does this all the time. It's actually a beautiful thing. That's Deion Thompson with the block, leading to Wayne Ellington throwing it down. North Carolina up 7-3, but Penn, they're smart kids and they can shoot the long range stuff. That's Tyler Bernardini, his 3rd three-pointer of the game. It's close, guys. Penn down by 2, but Ellington bombing right back with a 3-pointer. 6 zip run makes it 33-25 in North Carolina. Well, they keep on pouring it on. Inside, that is Danny Green at the half. UNC winning this one. To the gridiron now. We got North Carolina, we got Maryland, we got rainy weather. That's why it's so much better to be right here in ESPN here, right?
Yes, nice warm studio.
That's how we like to do it. And this is how UNC likes to do it. Cam Sexton to Cooter Arnold. Anybody named Cooter in here? Francais, is Cooter?
No, it's not, I'm sorry.
Okay, no problem. We got a French fan from Wake Forest. He's actually an alum, which is always good. That's Davin Meggett, 14-12, Maryland, and Michael McAdoo. He is gonna wrap up Chris Turner. And right now, we have North Carolina over Maryland at the half, 15-14, hold the applause. And then Clemson, the final, taking down Duke 31-7. Now, right now, we're having a great time because we are watching Wake Forest and North Carolina State. That's why we have the young alums. You know, they told us we were going to have alum in the house, and I was thinking like 40, 50, 60-year-old people. No offense to all you older folks out here, but we love these guys because they have the energy. Tie game right now at the half. How you feeling for your pack?
I'm confident in the Wolfpack. I think Russell Wilson's doing a great job. He brings a lot of faith to us. Andre Brown keeps pounding, you know, down the field. I think our defense will bring it, you know, do well in the second half.
See? You see that? Come on, North Carolina State. That's how we do it. That's why we do it over here.
Tell me about Wake. What can they do?
We seem to contain the quarterback. I think we'll get rolling second half. We'll see.
The beast.
There we go. We have more highlights, but as you can see, I got to find my shot sheet for Cal Oregon State. It's on the floor here. You guys are so sloppy. It's unbelievable. Here we go. California Oregon State. I believe this is the one. Let's roll the highlights. We got this one, and the Beavers, if they went out, they go on to the Rose Bowl, not USC. Is that a shocker for you?
Still have some games to play, Lowell.
Well, James Rogers, you're not going to catch him.
No. Not Cal's going to answer.
Well, Oregon State, they tied the game at that point at 7. But actually, Oregon State, it's the answer. It's Sammy Strotter. This kid has been through so much. All the emotional problems last season, distractions away from the field was not a factor for Oregon State, but he comes back here doing what he does best. 56-yard punt return down to the 2, set up a Beavers touchdown to make it 14-7.
Now it's double pass.
Yep, and the double pass working. Nyan Boating, 30-yard touchdown reception, and Oregon State's in control. Oh, look at that. We're going to see this team right here. This is Air Force, that's BYU. Highlights coming up next on SportsCenter U. Welcome back to the SportsCenter U Halftime Report. We need some noise in here. Okay, that's more like it. Penn State over Indiana, 34-7. The Buckeyes of Ohio State, 30-20. Beanie Wells and Terrell Pryor, both with 100 yards rushing. What do you think about that, Killer?
I think it was great.
Do you? Yeah. Now, you got another highlight for us?
Brett, give me your Chris Berman expression here.
Probably gonna have, I think we're going to have to do it in the highlights.
In the highlights.
In the highlights. We'll do it live in the highlights.
Okay, go.
All right.
Go, go.
Despite losing in the Big House and nasty weather, Michigan's still able to fill it up. First quarter.
That's Montavious Odoms.
That's not Dan Connors recovering. That's Northwestern's Eric Peterman. And on the ensuing drive, Steven Simmons takes it back. Great, wrong sport. He's into the end zone there, Coach. 7-0 Northwestern. Now we're tied up at 7. Ricky Reyes blocks the Vinny Cole punt.
Back.
It is recovered for a touchdown. 14-7 Michigan. Third quarter, 14-all. C.J. Bechet finds Peterman for the touchdown. That'll make it 21-14 in the snow.
Is that sleet or snow, though?
That could be either one. Late in the fourth, fourth down Michigan. Nick Sheridan incomplete, and that is the first win for Northwestern at Michigan since 1995. You know who was the running back then, Coach?
No.
Former Carolina Panther Tim Biakaputuka.
Hey. Oh, see, he knows his stuff here.
Good job.
Now, this is the first time that Michigan has ever had 8 losses in a season, ever. You go back to all the great coaches, all the great players like Biakaputuka, first time ever. You know, programs, I don't want to say North Carolina State is on that level, but when you're struggling a little bit, what does it do when you see a team like Michigan having the issues that they are?
Makes me angry.
Makes you angry? Okay. Well, I thought you'd be a little excited about it.
Well, I'm really excited.
I can tell. It's just, you know, the excitement is pouring out right here in the SportsCenter U studio. Now, we got to also talk about the Mountain West as they almost trip over chips and a Diet Pepsi. Is that your Diet Pepsi? Get it out of the way. BYU and Air Force, Todd Newell putting it in for Air Force. And you know what? This was your upset special, wasn't it, Coach?
Air Force over BYU.
But right now, Air Force at the half, 14-10. More to come. We're going to go back out to North Carolina State. DJ Bolden and Marshall Williams, 64 yards. We have a tied game at 14. Back to SportsCenter U Halftime Report. Texas all over Kansas, 35-7. We had something choreographed, but I don't think it's going to work.
Texas.
It kind of worked. Nebraska had the half over Kansas State, 35-14. And Baylor. The Baylor Bears beating up on Texas A&M, 13-7. Surprise, surprise, the Bears actually a favor in that game. Kelly, during this game, you were concerned about your Wake Forest defense after talking to Doug and Charles. How do you feel now?
I feel a little bit better about it. We were able to contain a little bit better that last quarter, but I'm still a little bit nervous. I'm still looking for some big hits and to contain a little bit better. I'm looking for more. I know that we've got a lot more in there.
Well, we'll see a lot more coming up in the second half. What do you think the second half coming up, Coach?
Both quarterbacks making plays. They're keeping the drives alive. They're keeping the plays alive.
Guys, you having fun? Are you having fun? That's the most important thing. Coming up next, we have the second half. Russell Wilson putting his North Carolina State Wolfpack in a pretty good position. We are tied at the half, 14-all. Why is it so quiet? I'm lonely.
Welcome back to ESPNU College Football, presented by Allstate and in high definition. We're all tied up as we start the third quarter. At halftime, while you were away, look at the skies. Time-lapse photography, and it goes from light to very ominous. And the rain is starting to fall now at Carter-Finley Stadium.
And the kickoff is deep into the end zone, and here they come. Breaking it to the outside is Devin Brown. Again, the wind is a factor. All right, guys, Doug Bell along with Charles Arbuckle. The weather could be a factor. We're watching that very closely, but what an entertaining first half. Somehow Wake Forest has to figure out a way to pressure the young quarterback at NC State.
Yeah, they need more offensive plays. I mean, that's the one thing. NC State did a very good job of controlling the first half, the number of plays, time of possessions, and also really doing a very good job of just keeping the ball. Look at that, 19 minutes versus 10 for Wake Forest. And third down conversion, that's where NC State did a very good job of keeping and controlling that clock.
That total plays are lopsided in favor of NC State. Back to the ground it goes, to Pendergrass. Flags down at the end of that play. Looks like that'll go against NC State, possibly grabbing the face mask. That's the initial sign. Goes against J.C. Neal.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 14, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run.
And in the highlights, there were plenty of them, especially for Russell Wilson.
Well, Russell Wilson, early on, able to get that ball down the field to Brian. And then D.J. Bolden playing Mr. Playmaker at the quarterback position, getting it down to Marshall Williams for six. And then Russell Wilson behind a good block by Jamel Eugene, getting in for 6 points. And Riley Skinner finding D.J. Bolden. D.J. threw a touchdown and also caught one.
Following the 15-yard face mask penalty, it's back to the ground for Pendergrass. And the coach has told us we might see Josh Adams back after that high ankle sprain he suffered 3 weeks ago against Miami, but so far have not seen Adams.
Yeah, he's the ACC Rookie of the Year last year. And look at the drive for Wake in the first half. Punt, touchdown, interception, touchdown. Not a lot of possessions.
Second down now after Pendergrass was thrown for that loss. Two drives, two touchdown drives each, and NC State eating up the time. Wake Forest quick strikes. Skinner looking for Bolden. That's a completed pass. Boy, Skinner was very patient, waiting for Bolden to make that cut.
Does a good job also, that sprint action boot. Doug, he gets outside the pocket. They're trying to stay away from Nate Irving and some of the other guys inside. And Riley Skinner just works his way around to D.J. Bolden. D.J. Bolden ran a nice route also. Came back to the football. It's tough for the defender, DeAndre Morgan, to cover all that ground.
Third down and two. Many of these folks are still working their way back to their seats. After the halftime, Pendergrass gets the first down, breaks the tackle, looking for another block, and gets it inside the 30, and carries a defender down to the 26. That was a 19-yard run.
Very good run by Pendergrass, and we saw him last week do some of the same things. And he works over to the other side, and just the blocking.
His
white jersey's coming off and really pushing back, and see Marshall Williams with a good block downfield.
So Pendergrass has been a spark plug for this Wake Forest offense. Career high 110 yards a week ago against Virginia, and he was the Rookie of the Week, as Buck mentioned. Shea McKean is the injured player, the defensive end for NC State. They're checking out his right ankle, and we'll tell you more when we come back. Wake Forest has come out fired up in the third quarter with a pinpoint drive, at least so far. The rain is coming down. It's supposed to get heavier as we look at the radar. We're in Raleigh right in the middle. You see all the green stuff. They say the red stuff, the severe weather, is south, and we hope it misses us to the east. Back to Pendergrass. Moves forward on first down. There's Nate Irving on the stop for NC State. Again, Irving missed three games with that bad ankle, and last week against Duke, all he had was 10 tackles, one pass breakup, one forced fumble.
And with all those, you know, all those games that he's missed, Doug, still 5 sacks on the year. 3 interceptions, 1 for a touchdown. Always seems to be around the football.
It's Renfred at fullback, right behind Skinner. And Pendergrass, that's what he did last week. Always got those quick feet.
Great blocking up front. Picks up five.
You know, Joe Looney has done a very good job. Watch big Joe Looney here, the guard. And he's going to come off and he's going to block Nate Irvin. That's not an easy task. But you got all these other guys. See Joe Looney, boom. And that kind of starts it. Now, Looney likes to grab and wrestle around, but he's much bigger than Nate Irvin. And it just goes to show you those inside runs, why they were effective for Wake last week with Russell Neenan and Nate and Joe Looney.
Got the tight end, the fullback. And Winfrett will take the handoff. And he gets thrown backwards.
He didn't get it. Doesn't look like where they come in with the spot that he got that, Doug.
Has to get it just past the 16-yard line. It looks like they'll mark it just on the other side.
No, Renfred has been a key guy in their resurgence after getting beat by Maryland and coming back, deciding on what they were going to do. They went to the Miami game, Wake Forest did, and decided to throw a run. They only threw the ball 8 or 9 times, and Renfred now has become the eye guy. He's been the back that leads when they go into the eye, and has had a key resurgence for this offense.
A raucous Carter-Finley Stadium. Here comes Wake Forest. Pendergrass right into big number 97, Willie Young, and he does not get it. A huge stop for the Wolfpack defense.
And much maligned Willie Young, who's got all the potential in the world, finally starting to play like they want him to here. He comes off the ball and makes a huge play. Gets off the block of Joe Birdsong, gets on his feet and comes up. Great individual effort play, 97. You see him blocked inside there, and then he's just able to get up. Willie Young was benched early in the year for playing a little bit too much freestyle defense, but right there that time, that was huge defense for Mike Archer and his defense.
Mike Archer challenged these guys 3 weeks ago, called them a laughing stock. And he said several players, they were ticked off at him, but they have responded just as the offensive line has done, and Andre Brown. That picks up 14 yards.
That's why the umpire you see that got run over is usually a bigger guy, because he's in the middle of all that fracas. And Andre Brown, and I'm going to show you where the umpire is. He's right here. He's the guy that's right behind the linebackers. He's got to be a big guy to be able to take the punishment in there. But all seriousness aside, all kidding aside, he has to run out of the way. Andre Brown was running up his back. Sorry about that, Mr. Umpire. Didn't mean to run over you.
Well, sometimes that happens, as we've seen many times this year already. A lot of time. There's Andre Brown, the dump off.
So what Wake is now trying to do is they're trying to chip Andre Brown or Jamel Eugene every time they come out to not let them get a free release on their linebacker. See the first half, the possessions for NC State. Touchdown, 2 punts and then a touchdown. But the time of possession for them was huge. They kept the ball and they were able to control the clock.
Second down, 11. See if Wake Forest comes with some pressure. Back to Andre Brown, goes over to the right side. He picks up 4 yards. Let's go down to Melissa, who talked with Coach O'Brien at halftime. Melissa?
I did, Doug, and he told me he doesn't have any complaints about how his team played during the first half. He likes the way they attacked Wake Forest. He likes the way they were able to control the time of possession. He just wants them to limit Wake Forest's ability to make those big plays and scoring fast. That's something he also wants to limit Wake Forest doing the second half. And you can see they're attacking Wake Forest right now, so could be another fun second half.
We shall see. Wake Forest drove down, had a field goal, but opted to go for it on fourth down and gets thrown backwards. And now NC State on third down. There's the blitz from the outside. That goes nowhere.
They're really trying to dial it up, come with the corner blitz off the edge with Alfonso Smith. You know, you don't want to lose him in coverage, but you got to take some chances. And Chip Vaughn, the free safety, slides over and does a very good job making the tackle.
This will be the third punt for Bradley Pearson. And Bolden will go deep for Wake Forest. Alfonso Smith on the outside. They giving us a look that they're going to come after it again. And here they come. Smith dives and came so close. He came within a whisker of blocking that one, but Pearson gets a nice roll. D
Didn't look pretty, but that goes for 48 yards, zero on the return. Pearson does his job. Some people have the luck of the draw underneath the shelter, getting out of the rain as they're avoiding trouble here. Wake Forest, the rain is rolling in. We'll see how bad and heavy it gets as we progress in this one. Wake Forest needing a victory and a Maryland loss to stay on top of the Atlantic Division. And then needing just a win next week at home against Boston College to make the ACC championship. You see Steve Lebosky, longtime offensive coordinator at Wake Forest. And he loves coaching with Jim Grobe. Talked to him this week about being a head coach because he's a sharp guy, Buck. And he's really a go-getter, an outstanding recruiter. And I think he's just happy working with Coach Grobe.
Well, and a lot of these guys on his staff have stayed with him unless they get head coaching opportunities or something better. They like working for him.
Skinner to Pendergrass on the outside. Pendergrass gets wrapped up and thrown backwards.
That's one of those plays where Pendergrass, you thought he would have a chance, and they just really wrestled him down. You know, working in the flare route to the short side of the field. Riley Skinner looking for him. Pendergrass had really nowhere to go. Good defense by North Carolina State.
So it's second down and nine. NC State's defense has really ramped up the aggressive nature. I mean, they're getting after him today. They're not a great tackling defense. It makes some mistakes, but they are playing with a lot of intensity today. Skinner wide open. That's a first down to Marshall Williams. That goes for 14 yards.
Well, you talk about Mike Archer and his unbelievable ability to understand how to dial it up.
Buck, our Taco Bell impact player update. At the start of the game, we talked about the two quarterbacks, and here's what they've done so far. They've been pretty good.
Yeah, they really have. And Russell Wilson had three drops, so you could add that should be 16 to 26. But they are the two guys that really have to make this offense, these offenses go. And you can see that Riley Skinner, one interception, but one touchdown as well.
Pitch back, Pendergrass has some space. Nice tackle by J.C. Neal. And not before a 9-yard pickup by Pendergrass. Just shy of the first down.
He's a little bit shaken up. He needs to come out for a play. And now the carry made is Josh Adams gets a chance to come in at the very end. This is good. They're trying to now run those sweeps. Last week they worked inside. This week, now they're trying to get him outside because the teeth of that defense for North Carolina State, they're doing a good job internally.
Pendergrass took that shot in the thigh. Now Josh Adams, his first carry in 3 weeks, and he gets the first down. Picks up five. Adams looked pretty good in that carry.
As a running back or any position, when you lose your starting job, you know you have to fight back. He's been running with the second team, but he was, like I said, ACC Rookie of the Year last year. And he's been practicing, but hadn't quite been able to play the last few weeks. It looks like he's got to bounce back in his step.
Adams lines up to the left of Riley Skinner now, first and 10. Wake Forest team looks to the sidelines and gets the signal. Adams hadn't played in 3 weeks, has to get in the right position. There's Adams. Gets knocked out of bounds. Takes a seat. Nate Irvin gave him a shove. Picks up 8 yards.
Well, Doug, some of that too is Riley Skinner trying to get him in the right position. So if they want him to sneak out of the backfield, that's what he's been able to do. But Nate Irvin. Let's go take a seat. You know, Nate will hit you even in the on the sideline if he could. He and Aaron Curry are those aggressive, physical, collision kind of guys.
Belton in at fullback and takes the carry. Stretches forward. And I think he will have a first down. We'll check. Two more games tonight on ESPNU. College football primetime presented by City in high definition, UConn and Syracuse. After our game at 7 Eastern, then Delaware State against Norfolk State. That's the Hornets and the Pirates. And don't forget ESPNU.com for all that is college sports.
Check out the latest on all the basketball upsets, like Kentucky losing to VMI last night. Shocker at Rupp Arena. Adams has been busy since he entered the football game for the first time. He spins forward for a pickup of four, and I tell you, Adams, he told us that his ankle did feel better, and he's looking pretty sharp right now.
He wants to get back in the game. He saw Brandon have a good game last week, and that competition makes you heal a little bit quicker.
Carried it 21 times for 110 yards against Miami 3 weeks ago, and really got nicked up, twisted that ankle. Set out the last 2 weeks. Now he's lined up to the right of Riley Skinner. Skinner to the outside. DJ Bolden, the pressure was coming down on Skinner, so he really threw that out of bounds.
NC State doing a good job of not allowing Riley Skinner to get, you know, it took so long for it to take place, the play fake and then trying to get outside. And talking about Mike Archer again, he grew up under the system of Bill Armsparger and a great defensive mind. Had the no-name defense with the Miami Dolphins, coached at LSU, so been around the league, and Mike Archer, a good quality defensive coordinator in his own right.
Four out of seven, third down so far today for the Demon Deacons. Skinner flagged down in the play.
So the biggest problem they were having is that they came with the blitz,
before the
protecting
snap,
it.
Ball start. Offense. Number 76. 5 yard penalty. Remains third down.
As Joe Birdsong.
Well, protecting it on the backside. Joe Birdsong's the left tackle. That's where they were coming with the blitz, and he knew it. And, you know, he was moving a little bit too quickly. People want to blitz, but you've got to also have guys that can cover behind it. If they can't cover, it makes no difference, because if you don't get there, they'll get burned.
Skinner flushed out of the pocket's got to hurry, and he ran out of time. Ran down from behind for an 8 yard loss is Nate Irving. Well, you talk about outstanding linebackers in the ACC. It may not be a great year for quarterbacks, but for linebackers, when you throw in Clint Sintem of Virginia and Nate Irving and Aaron Curry at Wake Forest, these guys are really good.
Watch the closing speed, though. Riley Skinner's going to try to get away, and he just tracks him down. Watch how fast he gets there. Joe Birdsong's trying to block. Look at the closing speed. Wow.
And the punt is away. Fair catch called for at the 16-yard line. That's a 33-yard boot. So NC State takes over. Wake Forest close, but in the end, Nate Irving does the job. Biter in Raleigh between NC State and Wake Forest. We're tied at 14. Wake Forest has had two possessions so far in this quarter and hasn't been able to do anything. They went for it on fourth and short in field goal range. Last drive, 8 plays, 60 yards, and the first one was a 9-play drive. So far, no points in the second half. Russell Wilson with all day to throw, and through the hands of Owen Spencer, who has just had a rough afternoon.
Well, that's his fourth drop, Doug, but also, too, what they're doing now, Stanley Arnaud or Chance McClinic, they're going to look up the running back so they don't get a free release. And that left Owen Spencer as the only guy to throw to, and he just had one of those games. He has just really struggled.
Brings up second down now. Wilson. Where Aaron Curry is and Arnaud, those middle linebackers getting know where they are in the running play to Eugene. Goes forward for a gain of one as we check in with Melissa Knowles down to the sideline.
Guys, as fans walked into the game today, there were collection bins for Toys for Tots. This is the second year that NC State has done that, has been a part of that event. And Coach Tom O'Brien, who is a former Marine Corps officer, it sits on the National Board of Directors of the Marine Corps Reserve, and they want to make sure kids who are not getting toys for Christmas are going to get some collected today. Last year, they collected about 1,400 toys. They're hoping that they double those efforts this year and get closer to their goal.
What a terrific cause headed by Tom O'Brien. Really urge the fans to
participate the last couple of years. There's a turnover, and Matt Robinson gets the loose football for Wake Forest. We'll see if Russell Wilson was down.
Yeah, it's going to be tough for
him. They're saying it's Wake Forest
Jamel
football.
Jamel Eugene came up with it at the end. He's the one that had the ball. But clearly, NC State had done a very good job of protecting the football, not giving it away. They're going to review this play, Doug, because Jamel Eugene came out of the pile with the football. You see Russell Wilson here finally getting chased from the backside by Alfonso Smith and getting hit low, and the ball is free right there. Now that's a battle. It's no telling who that ball changed his hands five or six times, I'm sure. You can see Jamel Eugene, 29, right there. He's going to come into the pile at some point. He ends up getting the ball out. Matt Robinson had a chance, but with it being wet, he slid right over the football. And you can see it right there coming out a little bit. Jamel Eugene comes up late to get it.
The call on the field is confirmed. First down.
So a big turnover for this opportunistic Wake Forest defense under Jim Grobe. And in the 8 years he has been there, they are plus 63 in the giveaway takeaway, which is absolutely amazing. And here's another one.
And who are usually the two guys to do it? Aaron Curry or Alfonso Smith? They're usually the ones to make the play. And they started bringing Alfonso Smith from the corner blitz. He can block punts, but he's also one of those guys that can rush off the edge and change the game for you. Good forced fumble by him. Wake now back in business.
Points off turnovers. Heavily favored for Wake Forest. They have been unbelievable in that department. Pendergrass back in the game. Like the way he breaks tackles and gets down inside the 6 yard line.
He just runs tough inside. He's almost one of those guys that's hard to find. The defensive lineman can't really find it behind the big guys, and then keeps his feet moving. Look at the legs. The leg drive just going. Talk about the ball control we talked about in the first half. Look at the second half. This is only the third quarter, and Wake clearly has the edge already. Almost more than what they had in the first half altogether.
Pendergrass to the left of Riley Skinner. That's Marshall Williams in motion. Pendergrass takes a pop. Gets it inside the 5 yard line. They have to get down to the 3 for a first down.
Gets Wake Forest after that recovery back to plus 14, which is first in the ACC, second in the country. So, you know, people talk about, well, how do you change your team? How do you become better? You play good, solid offense, but you also have to have great defense. And that's what they have here. Brian Knorr, wide receiver coach. He used to be the former coach at Ohio after Jim Grobe left.
Third down. Pendergrass, oh boy, he's wrapped up. Nate Irving shot through and sent him backwards, and I think they'll settle for the field goal now.
Hey, you talk about a big-time play. We talk about Aaron Curry all the time, but Nate Irving, and sometimes when you have guys like this, they want to make plays too. I'm going to get in there. I'm going to show you how quickly he times it perfectly. Doesn't get blocked at all. And then just great form tackling for the tackle for loss. Man, hello, how are you? I'm here. The door was open. I could just come in. I didn't have to knock.
Shane Popham now from 24 yards to break the tie. Third quarter, time ticking down. Popham delivers the field goal. It's 17-14 Wake Forest. The turnover results in 3. Demon Deacons staying on the ground, keeping it very conservative down here inside the 10-yard line.
Big time stop by Nate Irving. And, you know, you talk about bringing the blitz. But what he does is he times it perfectly and knows by assignment that Wake Forest, Barrett McMillan wants to move around, and he can just come right behind him where he vacated.
Jim Grobe with water coming down. It's raining in Raleigh. Let's check in with Lo Galindo in the Sports Center U studio.
Guys, now time for the conference update presented by Dr. Pepper, here with my friends from North Carolina State and Wake Forest. Percy Harvin, an 80-yard touchdown run, the longest touchdown of his career. Gators running away, like Percy, 35-3 in the third.
Boy, the speed of Percy Harvin and that entire Florida defense, their offense, it's spooky.
But I want to talk about the defense. Remember early on, everybody said Florida's defense is not going to be good. Brandon Spikes with the touchdown return. They have really played well on defense, and that's why they give their offense opportunities. And with all that speed, Jeff Demps, Percy Harvin, you know, Emmanuel Moody now coming back, getting healthy. He's playing well, taking some of the onus off of Tim Tebow. That's a tough team right now.
T.J. Graham deep for NC State. A week ago, Duke was doing the squib kick, and they did a reverse handoff to Graham just so he'd have an opportunity. This is just the pitching wedge, the short little pooch kick. And it's bobbled at the 21 by Clem Johnson. Gets tripped up out to the 31, 10 yards on the return. So the third quarter is now history. Wake Forest, they dominated time of possession in the third quarter. Riley Skinner and company resulted in just a field goal. And the nail biter continues in Raleigh, 17-14 Demon Deacons, one quarter to play. Russell Wilson has dedicated this season to his father, Harrison, and we'll tell you that story, which is heartwarming, especially since what has happened so far today. Andre Brown to the outside, and he gets pushed out of bounds. Now, before the season began, Russell Wilson's father, Harrison, had a severe stroke, and it had to do with a diabetic situation, actually had a leg amputated. And this is the first time he's been able to see his son play this season as he sits in Coach O'Brien's area in the end zone. And boy, that's a wonderful story. I know Russell is so excited that dad is watching him in person today.
Yeah, he really is. And gotten the opportunity to see him. He's playing well, by the way.
He's going right into that end zone where dad is watching. He rolls out. Knew that first down marker was trying to get closer. Picks up 12 yards on the scamper.
Aaron Curry was chasing him, but got cut blocked and couldn't get to him. 59 right there, trying to do a little hurdle move backwards and trying to chase Russell Wilson, can't get to him.
Boy, that's impressive though with Aaron Curry as he stepped over that blocker. I mean, that's just God-given talent. You can't teach that.
Yeah, look at that. Two halves, totally different for both teams.
And a handoff to Andre Brown. Trying to bring NC State back. Kevin Patterson shoved him out of bounds.
I really like how Andre Brown is running between the tackles and finishing runs. He just stays with it. He's going to keep moving. And even though he stopped in the backfield, Alfonso Smith with the one hand and tries to hit him. Keeps going. He just keeps going and keeps moving.
Getting that good blocking. Now second down and short, so he has options now, Russell Wilson and company. Fakes right, fakes left, keeps it himself. That's a first down. Kevin Patterson on the stop for Wake Forest, but it's a 10-yard pickup for Russell Wilson.
Well, he's able to find the opening. And he recognizes, okay, I've got to find this area. Right here is where he's able to attack. And then you can see down the field, Kevin Patterson is the only one there. He tries to fake him out, doesn't get by him. See the little move? But it's enough to keep the chains moving and also recognition and reacting to the recognition by Russell Wilson.
61 yards on the ground for Wilson matches Andre Brown, who also has 61. Out of time. That internal clock just went buzz as he dumps it off to Jamel Eugene, picks up nine more, so they're just marching right back down the field.
Well, a quarterback has to be good with his eyes, even in the run game, because if he knows he wants to take off, the defenders can see that, and they're trying to look for him to see where he's going. Russell Wilson also in the passing game knows, okay, I got to get rid of this. Aaron Curry coming. Let me just take my guy underneath the dump-off receiver who has been getting banged up when they go inside. Jamel Eugene able to sneak away from those linebackers and get open for the catch.
Tight ends run in and out for NC State with the play call. George Bryan now in at right side tight end slot. Eugene goes right up the gut, gets another first down.
You know, you'd say, well, why run Jamel Eugene? Well, he's a very powerful individual. He's one of the stronger guys pound for pound in this NC State program. You know, not as big as Andre Brown, but he's just as effective running the ball in the middle of the defensive line.
Eugene went and talked to Tom O'Brien when he took over the program, and he said, listen, if I'm not going to play, I want to transfer.
Shoot straight to me. And Tom O'Brien and his staff said, hey, we're going to use you. He said, right now?
Yeah, told him to be patient. And now Brown.
But part of that was because Andre Brown was here, Tony Baker. There were a lot of guys in front of him. He didn't think he was going to have a chance to get on the field.
So Andre Brown, final season, senior from Greenville, North Carolina. We're live from Carter-Finley Stadium. Raleigh, North Carolina, Wake Forest 24th in the land against NC State. Doug Bell alongside Charles Arbuckle. Melissa Knowles down on the field. Total yards now. Wake Forest dominated that third quarter. In fact, they had it for 11 minutes in the third quarter. Got the field goal. There's the dump off.
Big Anthony Hill, the tight end, who was out for a few games. Finally making it back, getting healthy. The senior out of Houston, Texas, went to Clearbrook High School.
The torn pec muscle, Buck. I don't know if you ever had one. I haven't, but I understand it's pretty painful.
Yeah, I don't want to see how it feels either. But he was also battling back from a knee injury he had. You know, they expected a lot of things from him last year, got hurt, and now he's finally back, and he's made a difference to this offense, blocking and receiving.
So Brian back in there, tight end. The tight ends alternate every play. Wilson just dodging trouble and darting to the sidelines. He's out of bounds at the 8-yard line.
Doug, the other thing that they do, the receivers also know, and the running backs, when they get down the field, they must block, because he's going to, let me think, am I going to throw it? No, let me, okay, I'm going to run it. And when he does, you see guys up in front blocking for him. Taylor Gentry, the true freshman fullback, right there, making sure that he can assure his guy doesn't make the tackle. And I think a lot of these guys are more keen on that now, because they know Russell doesn't want to always run, and especially after what happened in the South Carolina game, you try to protect the quarterback from any vicious hits that he'll get when he runs or scrambles.
10th play of the drive, 171 straight passes without a pick for Russell Wilson. He just throws that away and make it 172. Boy, he makes smart decisions.
Yeah, his numbers don't always look great. Even though he has great passing efficiency, we've seen it tonight. This is about the fourth time that he's just gotten rid of the football.
Again, they're going into that end zone where his father Harrison is watching from the balcony. Those are the coaches' offices, and that's Tom O'Brien's office. First game Harrison has been able to watch in person. Obviously, he's seen Russell play on television all year, but there's something about watching your son in person.
Well, Doug, the other thing that Russell's done a good job in, North Carolina State has done as well, is protect against the blitz. They were blitzed the last two plays and still able to get out of that.
Third down. Again, he has all day into the end zone. It is a touchdown. Touchdown, NC State, Anthony Hill.
Wake had eight guys in the end zone and still couldn't cover. They only had three people rushing. Watch, they're going to rush three, and everybody else is going to drop back. So there's eight defenders basically in the end zone. Alfonso Smith comes out late and still can't keep up with Anthony Hill. Third touchdown on the year. But also, Russell Wilson makes that happen by just staying and working with it, and his receiver just finds the opening in the zone.
Schakowsky on for the extra point to give the Wolfpack a four-point lead, and he does it. Drills it right down the middle. And you have to be impressed by Russell Wilson. He looks like Fran Tarkington, dodging trouble and throwing right on the mark.
College football presented by Allstate. Another ACC backyard brawl. NC State leads Wake Forest 21-17. Rain pelting down.
Jim Grobe said, expect this to happen. You know, he told his guys, hey, you know these guys. You've grown up around some of them. You played little league football together. We know we're going to be in for a dogfight. They want to get to a bowl game, and we want to win the ACC. So it runs through Raleigh this week. Don't worry about what happens next week or the other weeks. Let's take care of our business now. And NC State is saying, let's get hot so we can get ourselves into a bowl position.
Pearson, a short pooch kick of his own, takes one bounce. Fielded by Brown at the 24, and he works his way up to terrific field position for the Demon Deacons out to the 37. And one more look at that touchdown.
Well, Russell Wilson had hurt them on that drive, running the football very well. So you're going to see Alphonso Smith right here. He's going to come into your screen, and he's going to spy. He's looking for him. But then right here is where the touchdown can come from. So very good job by Anthony Hill of staying alive. Alphonso Smith spying him. But seven defenders, six of them at that point were in the end zone, still couldn't stop him.
That was an 11-play drive, 69 yards, took just under 5 minutes. Skinner sees the blitz, fires it out to the right and off the fingertips of Brinkman. Should bring them usually sure-handed receiver, but that would have taken every bit of his talent. Jim Grobe told us this week we're not going to have a problem getting our kids up for this one. They have really good players, many of whom played high school ball with our guys. As I tell them, it's twice as hard to beat an ACC team on the road. And many believe this is the most hostile environment to come into in the ACC. It is loud. They are a factor. The 12th man, Pendergrass, over the right side now on second down. Will bring up third and long.
Doug, we've seen it over the last 2 years. No matter who comes in and what their record is, North Carolina State just seems to know how to play well at home. And their fans, you know, that tailgate they do before gets them revved up and ready to go.
4 out of 9 on third down. This will be third down and 7. Nate Irving looking for those defensive signals along with Robbie Leonard. Both have been big-time factors on this Saturday. Skinner with lots of time over the middle. Has a man wide open. And Bolden, did he pull it in? He's acting like he did. The signal is it's incomplete.
If he did not make the catch, he did an outstanding job of showing it, selling the catch. I mean, he reaches out and tries to go get that. DJ Bolden does. Riley Skinner buying time for his receiver. He just steps up into the pocket, Doug, and DJ Bolden stretches as far as he can. Clearly not a catch. I think the ball comes out, but he sells it at the end. Riley Skinner looking down the field. He finally finds his open receiver right here. You're going to see the ball. I don't know if he got his hands under, but DJ Bolden did a great job of reaching for it.
Well, Bolden, the leading receiver in the ACC, he believes he got his hand underneath it.
Only six players on the line of scrimmage. That penalty has been declined. It's fourth down.
Wouldn't have mattered for him anyway. They need seven on the line of scrimmage. Play wouldn't have counted.
So Shane Popham, his third punt today. He's averaging 38 on his first two kicks. He was such a weapon last week. Wake Forest could use one of those big booming 55-yarders that he did so well a week ago. Low snap. Popham not a problem. Lets this one fly with the wind at his back. Takes a Wake Forest bounce, an excellent bounce. This is going to carry him all the way down to the 6-yard line. 54 yards. Shane Popham, the freshman from Crestview Hills, Kentucky. ESPNU College Football is presented by Allstate, proud sponsor of college football in the 75th Allstate Sugar Bowl. Are you in good hands? Heck of a game brewing here in Raleigh as we enter late into the fourth quarter. Doug Bell alongside Charles Arbuckle. And yes, these funnel cakes, just some of the delicacies you can get at Carter-Finley Stadium.
Yeah, last year we were eating everything, and we sent Melissa one of these, and she had it and talked about how good it was.
And she got the sugar all over, if you remember. She didn't know how to eat it.
No.
You have to kind of hold it, balance it, and then pull it off, almost like French fries. Let's check in with Melissa. Melissa, do you know how to eat a funnel cake
now?
You
know what? That is not fair, you guys. Can y'all send me one up down here? Except, you know what? It might get kind of soggy.
It's raining too much.
But at least the wind won't blow the sugar all over me this year.
That's right. Boy, those funnel cakes are great.
Enjoy. Savor the flavor.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Enjoy that. Tell me how good that is.
We'll save you one.
Okay.
A few weeks ago at Boston College, we had that clam chowder, which was really good. And then today, prior to the game, they serve this North Carolina barbecue pulled right off the bone. Man alive, it was good. Making myself hungry talking about it. There's Eugene cutting back for a first down. That excites the big crowd here. That's a 10-yard run.
Well, Jamel Eugene's excited and hungry for yards. And he clearly wanted to pick him up. And he starts off going to the left of your screen and decides to cut back, and he has Russell Wilson out front picking up a nice block. I mean, Russell Wilson, watch this block. He goes in and gets a nice cut block. Finally, Kevin Patterson is able to bring Jamel Eugene down.
Closing in on the 8-minute mark now in the fourth quarter. NC State would love to run a little more time off, maybe three or four more minutes. Wilson fires that out of bounds. His Wake Forest defense is full of fifth-year seniors. When you look at the number of games that McClinic and Arnaud and Curry have played at linebacker, and you throw in Alfonso Smith and Kevin Patterson and Brandon G.
Watch the fake here. Stop it right there. See, when he lets the hand release, now you can let it go. The defense all moves over. Look, everybody is faked out. Then they try to come out. Even though he doesn't complete this pass, for a young quarterback, he does a very good job of staying with the fake. And you have to trust your line on that, because you're basically, you don't see what's going on behind you. You just have to trust that they've picked up their blocks and they're going to come out and make a play.
That's the experience we were talking about, and that's why Russell Wilson has been so impressive, because he's going against guys who played against the best for 5 years.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
he's not rattled.
No. Well, and I think they've been impressed. When they tell him a compliment of saying he looks like Riley Skinner, that's not a negative thing. That's a very positive thing.
Second down. Wake Forest looking for one of those quick three and outs to get the ball back to Riley Skinner. It looks like they might be headed in that direction. Kyle Wilbur on the stop of Eugene. That's just a 1 yard pickup.
Well, Doug, and to go a little bit further on that point about Russell Wilson, I think he would have more notoriety if North Carolina State was playing better. Ja'Cory Harris, we talk a lot about him and Ponder down in North Florida State and some of those other things, but he's just as good a player in his own right. Robert Marv at Miami.
Melissa?
You know, something I noticed after that last touchdown, when everybody was coming over here and chest bumping and high-fiving for getting that touchdown and going up 21-17 against Wake Forest, Russell Wilson was remaining composed, and he told his team, we have to finish. That's what he kept repeating.
Well, he gets sacked. Who else but Aaron Curry comes through just when they need him. So that was the three and out the Demon Deacons were hoping for, a 5-yard loss. So they're going to get the ball back with a ton of time on the clock.
You know, every time you need a play, it seems to be Aaron Curry or Alfonso Smith making it. And that time, Aaron Curry just says, hey, make the play. Let me get off the field. Let our offense get back on. Let's score some points. He's tied.
Fourth punt for Bradley Pearson. He's averaging close to 44 yards a kick. He's had a good day. He's kicking into the breeze. Boy, that was a high snap. Gets it away, and it takes an NC State bounce. Nothing on the return, but Wake Forest will have excellent field position. That was a 40-yard kick. Most of it was a roll, but it could have been worse. Pearson showing a little vertical jump there. Jim Grobe has won his share of close games, and his team now will have to rally with lots of time to go in the fourth quarter, 6-17.
We'll talk about Nate Irvin, the Alpha Wolf, because we're at Wolfpack land. always seems to know how to get to the football and be the leader of that defense. He was out for a while, but when he comes back with a bang right here on this stop earlier this evening. Just able to make plays just like Aaron Curry.
He's coming after him. Picked up that time. They got Irving. Skinner just throws that out of bounds. They bring up second down.
Seen that a lot tonight, the good coverage in the secondary. Well, that time, that was a coverage all the way down the field by Marcus Kuhn, who was playing that zone blitz area.
13 tackles on the day. Certainly headed for all ACC first team honors, along with Aaron Curry and Clint Sentum.
Six sacks on the year. Michael Ta'alalili around
having
down,
a terrific year. Boy.
Down the street, good play.
Quickly to the outside. Bolden, boy, what a tackle. Coming out of nowhere is DeAndre Morgan.
Defense, we talked about them making mistakes earlier and the things they haven't been able to do, and DeAndre looks like he's a little hurt. But a sure tackle outside on a big receiver who can usually run over guys. Nice play. I mean, just a very nice, solid play by DeAndre Morgan. He gives his body up. That's why he got hurt. He went in there and just refused to allow DJ Bolden to go anywhere with that ball.
If he had not made that tackle, Bolden had a lot of room, a lot of real estate in front of him. So he is shaken up after that hit.
Coaches on defense usually talk about selling out. DeAndre Morgan sold out on that play.
Tom O'Brien looking on a triple header tomorrow on ESPNU. We're talking hoops. It's Bradley. Head coach Jimmy Less was a great player at Bradley when they went to the NCAAs, and Hersey Hawkins was on the team. Taking on the Florida Gators down at the O-Dome in Gainesville. Then Lemoyne takes on Syracuse. And University of Missouri, Kansas City takes on the Jayhawks, the defending national champions, all tomorrow on ESPNU. Morgan is okay. He'll sit out of play. I think he wants to get right back in.
You have to come out after they stop the clock and officials call a timeout, but he wishes he could be there now.
Third down and 12. The crowd is really into this one. Ponchos and all. Skinner goes down. He is thrown down.
Willie Young. Once again, we talk about Big 97, how poorly he played earlier in the year, but he is able to get by Joe Birdsong. Joe Birdsong cannot block Willie Young when he decides not to be blocked. Watch right here. Willie Young, outstanding, just gets in there, and Riley Skinner never has a chance. Watch how quick he's off the ball. Joe Birdsong barely touches him. Brandon Pendergrass, usually you got to go to the first guy. He misses him as well. Look at this. This is an outstanding play by a guy who has all the physical tools, sometimes doesn't bring them all to the table.
He has played well today. Popham on for a big punt. His last punt was 55 yards. Fair catch called for at the 29, just a 39-yard kick. But once again, the Wake Forest defense has to come up with some stops against this NC State team, trying for their second win in a row. Let's check in now with Melissa down on the field.
You know, last year they collected 1,400 toys. Today, 3,100. So they more than doubled their total by 300 unwrapped presents. And I don't know if you guys know this, but Christmas is only about a month and a half away. So if you want to be nice to me and send me a funnel cake, I'll take that as a present.
Don't worry.
It won't get too soggy. I can eat it fast.
Don't worry. We got you one. High and dry up here in the box. Stick them to the ground. That's a 6-yard carry for Andre Brown, who's brought down by Aaron Curry.
And Doug, this becomes a situation where you call 4-minute offense. So the offense really wants to drive you into submission. They want you to use your timeouts, but they also want to keep the clock moving. And if they can get some first downs, that first play was good to get them in the right direction.
NC State, first five games, mighty struggle with so many injuries. Last four games, they have gotten better, which has given this entire unit lots of hope.
They got a shot to go to a bowl game if they can win out, because they would have to hang on tonight. They'd have to beat North Carolina.
Russell Wilson just threw one in the stands, and I've done arena football in the past. That's, he's thrown so many balls out of bounds, burned them, so to speak.
I mean, it's not an easy road. Tonight, if you win, you go 4-6, and then all you have to do is win in Chapel Hill and then beat Miami, which is won five in a row.
They can do that. Yeah, no problem.
Okay. That's why coaches never look ahead. Just don't worry about next week. We got work this week.
But they've gotten healthy at the right time, and they've really started to just play the way I think Tom O'Brien and his staff thought they would earlier this season.
And the blitz, not a problem for Wilson, who saw it and rolls to the right. He will be short of the first down. Picks up 2 yards, and so this will be another fourth down situation for the Pack.
Alfonso Smith is shaking up on that play.
And NC State, a long way from winning this game, but Tom O'Brien, if you look at his resume, 3-7 his first 2 years at Boston College, and then he went on a serious roll.
But we talked about it at the last break. They got a little conservative on the last two drives. So if Wake Forest finds a way to manufacture a touchdown, they may look back and say, hey, that's why I talked about 4 minutes. You got to get a couple of first downs, make them use their timeouts. Wake has done a very good job defensively the last two possessions.
Pearson on. Much better snap this time. A wobbly punt. It almost hit a Wake Forest player, and it now gets knocked out of bounds. That came dangerously close to hitting off the back leg of a Wake Forest player. It's a 29-yard punt. The worst of the game for Pearson. So once again, good field position for Wake Forest.
It almost hit 24, Michael Williams. And the return guy is usually the one to tell you, Peter, or clear, but he usually crosses his hands. Michael Williams almost let that ball touch him.
Last time, it was 3-and-out for Riley Skinner and company. Under 3 minutes, they have all three timeouts remaining. Skinner, Andrew Parker, freshman tight end from Jacksonville, Bowles got up underneath that ball and caught it.
We saw Riley Skinner do this before the half. Let's see if he can get a 2-minute drive going here again.
Rushing four, Skinner now to the outside. That's Marshall Williams. Two big defensive stops for NC State. The key plays, Buck.
Well, Nate Irvin, huge play by him of getting in untouched. And then Willie Young, both times, just an effort play by those individuals in reading and recognizing when they could, and they dialed it up and made it.
New set of downs, 1st and 10. Skinner takes it himself, gets tripped up, falls forward for a gain of 2. Marcus Kuhn, the German, makes the stop. Kuhn, an interesting story, 2nd-year man, who started playing at 15. That's as early as you can play in Germany. He's on a club team there, came over and found NC State. Skinner wiggles out of trouble to Bolden, who tries to stay in bounds, and he's out of bounds at the 49. Picks up 5.
Nate Irving had him in his grasp, but couldn't get to him. He comes free, and Riley Skinner able to just get away from him. That's the maturity and the poise. Nate Irving just missed him.
Riley Skinner with 5 career game-winning drives. Can he do it again? 3rd down and 4. And he gets thrown down. It's 4th down. They'll go for it. Wrapping him up. That's a big play by Augustine.
Audie Augustine plays a lot on special teams. Came in and did a very good job. You talk about a guy that could rush. It was a started some last year. But a huge play by Audie Augustine.
Jim Grobe, Coach Lobotsky, talking to that offensive unit, and boy, they're in the face of those offensive linemen. I mean, they're not doing a lot, just rushing four, and they're getting after Skinner.
Hey, have you ever seen a player just turn to the coach, hey, would you come out and try to block Willie Young and Nate Irvin and now Audie Augustine?
Doubleheader coming up on ESPNU, UConn, Syracuse from the Dome. That's immediately after our game. And then Delaware State, the Hornets against Norfolk State, the Spartans. That's coming up tonight, presented by City right here on ESPNU, presented in crystal clear high definition. Big crowd. We've gotten wet in the second half. A soaking rain has continued to fall, but we've avoided the serious weather. But here it is, fourth down. This is it for Wake Forest. They need a first down to keep it going. Skinner, a bad snap. And he's going to run for it. Skinner somehow gets the first down.
Wow.
That's a 12-yard pickup, a terrible snap.
Russell Neenan, only his fourth start at the center. Doesn't get the snap cleanly to him. The ball has to be wet from all the rain. He's just really focused on trying to get to the block before actually snapping the ball. And Riley Skinner stays calm, gets the ball, and picks up the first down.
First and 10. Two timeouts remain for the Demon Deacons. That's Bolden. He had the crisscross.
So, Doug, the problem with that play, you have Marcus Kuhn and Keith Willis in a zone blitz, so they're the guys underneath. They can't run with DJ Bolden, so he catches the ball and is able to just run across their face and stay going. You're going to see DJ Bolden come into your screen. Right there. Stop it. So there he is, and he keeps going. He's able to move.
Second down. And short. And that's the first down. Quickly to the outside, and that stops the clock. Marshall Williams on the receiving end. 1:21 on the clock. Wake Forest needs a touchdown. Early in the third quarter, they went for it. Close to the 5-yard line on fourth down, and they were stopped by Nate Irving. Boy, you think back, they kicked that field goal. And
it'd be easier to get three as opposed to seven or six, and then the PAT.
Riley Skinner trying to write another chapter in his wonderful career. Fires it to the outside, in and out of the hands of Chip Brinkman. That would have been a difficult catch. It was a difficult throw. Skinner almost should have just kept running that football.
Yeah, once again, you see all that green grass in front of him. Brinkman almost able to pull it up like a shortstop. A nice look at that one there.
Skinner with a pump fake to the outside. Williams, he stays inbounds.
But they get the first down, so the clock will stop until they set the chains. Actually, the officials are trying because the clock kept moving. Actually, I'm sorry, it's third down.
So Wake Forest calls their second timeout, one remaining.
He's looking at the side official, and he was acting like it was a first down.
Once again for the Demon Deacons, needing a victory today to stay on top of the Atlantic Division, depending on what happens with Maryland and North Carolina. Carolina's up 15-14 late in that game, 5 minutes to go. Maryland owns the tiebreaker over Wake Forest, but if Maryland should lose at home to Carolina, a win by Wake Forest today, they hold the tiebreaker over Florida State. In that crazy ACC.
Oh, man. You gotta love it.
Look at this crowd. You wouldn't know NC State is 3-6 on the season.
We talked about it driving over today. The folks tailgating, the excitement around the city just about this ball game. And you would have thought that Wake was, NC State was in a position right now to play for the ACC championship. They're playing like it.
Third down and six. And the blitz from the outside. Skinner sees it. Off the fingertips of Marshall Williams. He was open and the ball was there and he couldn't bring it in.
We've seen two young receivers, both sophomores, Owen Spencer with the drop earlier for North Carolina State, and Marshall Williams here. Riley Skinner places his ball perfectly for him to come underneath it and catch it. You've got to come away with that. He had Jeremy Gray beat, couldn't put it away.
So close. Fourth down. Wake Forest 1 of 2 today on fourth downs. The last one was Riley Skinner running for it. They're rushing four. Skinner somehow gets out of trouble. Looking in the end zone. Lets it fly. Bounces out of bounds. He will be down before he lost the football. And that's it. NC State will take over on downs with 39 seconds.
Doug, none of his receivers came back to give him any help. They kept running towards the end zone. And usually you got one guy that finds a way to say, okay, I'm going to get open for my quarterback. Allen Michael Cash stayed with it and kept going. You're going to see Riley Skinner looking down the field. Willie Young almost gets to him. And then down there, Allen Michael Cash running. But you see no receiver showing up. He had nowhere to throw it. Huge play by the NC State defense. Really coming away with it.
There was a flag down after the play. Allen Michael Cash ripped that helmet off in celebration. So it looks like it'll be 15 yards. Unsportsmanlike conduct against NC State as the officials huddle.
There is no penalty.
All right.
For the player removing his helmet, it was knocked off in play.
There you go.
No foul.
So he didn't rip it off. It got knocked off.
He needed a breather. Willie Young took it off his head. Willie Young, so excited, took his helmet off, almost tackled him.
So there's the knee by Russell Wilson.
Well, Doug, last week against Duke, NC State had a great goal line stance in the third quarter. This week, they had a couple of key stops on drives, and one on the fourth down with Nate Irvin. Makes a big difference.
Last timeout by Wake Forest. Stops the clock at 31 seconds, but all the Pack has to do is kneel down. You look at the big defensive stops. Nate Irving, Willie Young.
And Nate Irving both there on fourth down. Another one by Nate Irving solo. And then again, Willie Young with the key sack and stop. And once again, Audie Augustine getting in the mix. And then the last one was huge. But I think also, too, what really hurt him is that Riley Skinner had no one to throw to in that picture. You saw he had nowhere to go. And a huge win for North Carolina State.
So Russell Wilson was so impressive. The first time his father fighting back from a stroke comes to see him in person. That's Harrison Wilson. And Papa has to be so proud. Tom O'Brien, Jim Grobe. Shake hands.
What did Jim Grobe say? How difficult it is to win on the road in the ACC.
So once again, the ACC race in both divisions is absolutely chaotic. Atlantic Chaos Conference. Final score, NC State 21, Wake Forest 17. Coming up next, we'll take you back to the studio, get you up to date on all of today's action. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Charles Arbuckle, Melissa Knowles, our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Doug Bell. So long from Raleigh, North Carolina. Once again, the Pack wins their second straight behind the freshman quarterback, Russell Wilson. The Demon Deacons go on the road and go home a loser. Let's go to the studio in Logalindo.
This is Sports Center U.
Welcome into Sports Center U. Yes, the alums from Wake and North Carolina State, they've been here watching the win. North Carolina State victorious, and Coach, the floor is all yours. Look at those beautiful trophies.
They're beautiful.
They're actually
on
kind
behalf of ESPNU, it's an honor to bestow on these winners here today.
Yep.
We spare no cost here.
Not at all.
Pick up the trophy.
It's kind of small. It's going to be tough for you to get your, maybe your pinky can slide in there. There you go. Be careful. It's a small one. It's fragile. And that's the second place.
This is a second place trophy. I'd like to have the captain from Wake Forest.
Yeah. Come on, guys. Make some,
thank you,
some noise for
thank
him.
You very much. Good game. You almost came back
almost
there. Almost win. one.
And you also get water bottles. Here's a water bottle for you. Come on, guys, heads up. You don't leave empty-handed. While I'm doing this, why don't you hand out the first place trophy?
Okay, the championship trophy, the winning trophy.
We on behalf are the champions,
of ESPNU,
my friend.
And Lowell, I'd like to present you as the winner of this game. Thank you.
Yes, I accept this trophy on behalf of North Carolina State and the offensive line for giving Russell Wilson time today. Thank you.
And that's what it's all about. Now, Coach, we talked about Riley Skinner, and when we saw that final drive, you were bringing it up to me. This is where Riley Skinner is his best. What happened late to make all the North Carolina State fans so happy?
He did a great job. He had a wide-open receiver for the TD, just couldn't hold on to the ball.
He just said ACC champs. You've got two wins in the ACC. Oh, next year.
Next year.
Looking
next year.
Forward to season number three under Tom O'Brien.
Right now, we'd have to turn the paper upside down, but
exactly.
It's getting better.
Anything's possible. Can we get a shot, though, of the Wake Forest kids?
Yeah, they're not.
The corner. It's okay,
it's,
guys. It's okay.
It's young people.
It's young people. They take the lard.
They're down.
They take it loss. You know.
They're down.
But, guys, right now we're going to turn over to the Southeastern Conference. Is that okay with you guys? Talk a little Florida. Florida comes in number four in the BCS. They were going up against South Carolina. Last time this game was in Gainesville, Steve Spurrier had his guys attempt a field goal.
Almost.
Florida blocked it. Gators went on to win the national championship. Chris Smelly, what are you doing?
Fourth in turnovers in the country. Florida's defense, they turned the ball over three times. South Carolina made too many mistakes early.
It was Brandon Spikes, pick six, then Percy Harvin taking it in for the score. Tim Tebow, get this, over the last 3 weeks, he leads the nation in passer efficiency.
That was a push-off.
And in rushing touchdown.
That was a penalty.
I didn't see any laundry, though, Coach.
It was a push-off.
Well, there's one for
too
Percy
much
Harvin,
speed.
But that's a speedy stiff arm, 80 yards. That is his longest touchdown of his career.
12 TDs in 12 straight games.
Now, did you notice Steve Spurrier was going from the hat to the visor? Have you ever seen anything like that? I know he likes the two quarterback system, but the visor and the hat?
When you're behind 49-6, the next thing that comes is a Groucho Marx classic.
Well, this one is almost over. Florida about to win six straight SEC games, and they're about to do this. Almost all of them have been by at least 30 points. The one last week, 28 points. I still think they'll take that. When we talk about Florida, are we talking about the hottest team in the country besides the North Carolina State Wolfpack? Yeah.
Hot and fast. And they have a run right now. They have Florida State on the road, and then they get to championship game, Alabama, anything's possible now.
Well, we've talked to our BCS expert, Brad Edwards, and he says that right now, Florida controls their destiny as much as Alabama does in the SEC. If they meet in the SEC title game, we know that's going to happen. Gators run the table before that, and they win that. They're playing in Miami for that national championship. Texas also trying to get some help. First off, they had to go up against the Kansas Jayhawks up in Lawrence. It's very, very cold. You know us Texas boys, when you put us in the cold, that's not a good combo. I'll tell you what is a good combo. Colt McCoy. He doesn't need anybody else,
no.
Coach.
Wide open, got some good blocks. TD.
And right here, we're going to see Kansas absolutely punishing Blake Gideon. Gideon out cold. And remember, Blake Gideon, he was a youngster, true freshman, that had that dropped interception against Texas Tech. He appeared to be okay, was not cold. There's Brandon Collins with the touchdown. Texas, yee-haw, 35-7. Now, with this win, Texas moves into a tie with Miami. As far as most consecutive 10-win seasons, 8 in a row, all under Mack Brown. We know the Longhorns need some help. But right now, they're sitting there pretty good in the BCS, number three right now. Do you still like their chances to slip in first off to the Big 12 title game before thinking about the BCS national title?
Yes, I believe Oklahoma will beat Texas Tech, and Texas will be the team.
Now, I don't know if Texas will go on enough of a slide to possibly meet North Carolina State in a bowl game. Well,
basketball.
Let's just say it happens. If Texas meets the Wolfpack, they are thundering now, two straight wins. What happens?
They're going down.
North Carolina State?
No, Texas.
Oh, see, I was confused on that. I was a little confused on that. But, you know, Wake Forest, you guys
are down.
Cheer up, guys. I mean, it's a little depressing right now. Let's move on to Georgia and Auburn. Coach, you buying this as possibly the final home game for Tommy Tuberville?
Could be. He needs to beat Alabama next week.
Well, he needs to beat Georgia. First off, Cody Burns, Mario
Not
Fannin.
Not going
to
happen.
52. Well, you've already seen the game, Coach. You can't give it away. They missed the extra point. Auburn up 6-0. Cody Burns back to work. Fannin again back to work. He's got some moves, Coach. Could you ever do anything like that back in the 1930s when you were playing?
Not the 30s.
Not the 30s, 20s, my bad. Auburn up 13-0. Matt Stafford, A.J. Green. Is he the best freshman receiver in the country?
Yes, he very well could be.
There's a guy named Julio Jones out there. Cody Burns, incomplete at the end of the game, and Georgia taking this one 17-13. So for the first time since 1999, we're talking about an Auburn team with six losses on the season. We brought it up, Tommy Tuberville. Are we saying goodbye, Tommy?
Could be. Big game.
We need yes or no, game, Coach. We need yes or no.
I'm saying a big game in 2 weeks against Alabama. If he wins that game, he'll be back. If he loses a game, order the moving truck.
What do you say about Georgia? Because remember last week, Kentucky has the ball on a late drive, and they have their freshman quarterback throw an interception. Amazing play by the defensive lineman for Georgia. But in two straight weeks, the Bulldogs taken to the wire. This was the preseason number one team.
You have to win close games to be a great team.
Well, you guys want to do a little basketball? You guys want to do a little North Carolina highlights?
No.
Of course. Well, North Carolina is the number one team in the nation. Coming into the season, they were taking on Pennsylvania, not Penn State. Pennsylvania, the Smart Kids. Early on, Smart Kids with the advantage. Tyler Bernardini, third game, third three-pointer of the game. Penn making it close. Wayne Ellington making it not so close. North Carolina pulls away.
Where's the North Carolina football highlight?
I don't know. Those are coming up next. I believe that. Tyler Zeller, he's a freshman. He's good. Jack Eggleston. You can never have too much Eggleston. Penn within 10. But then it was just a little too much from Tyler Zeller, one of the top power forwards coming into this season. North Carolina winning 86-71. Let's do a little North Carolina football now, guys, shall we?
This is big right here.
Why?
Bigger than the basketball game.
North Carolina and Maryland. Cam Sexton to Cooter Arnold.
Cooter.
Okay. Yeah, Cooter. Can we? What do you have to do to earn the nickname Cooter?
I don't know, be the Duke's Hazard or something?
You got to drive a tow truck.
I don't think Cooter does that, but he was good for the touchdown. Then we see Devin Meggett making it 14-12. Maryland, Brooks Foster, 32 yards. That sets up a field goal to make it 15-14, North Carolina. Uh-oh. And then they give me a name like this, Obi Egakaza, booting it in from 26 yards out. And that makes it 17-15. Maryland right now leading Duke and Clemson. Now, do you guys think Duke are smarter than you guys from North Carolina State?
No, they're definitely not.
Of course not. Only one of the top academic institutes in the nation. Why would they be that? C.J. Spiller, 83 yards. Tigers up 24-0. And then Aaron Kelly into the record books. The ACC's all-time leading career receiver. And he gets that done right there. So, now we need a little fan participation. We got Duke, we got North Carolina. They share the state with you guys. We need to know which one, you know, you don't like more than the other. I don't want to say hate. That's such a hateful word. Who are you going to take?
I can't stand Duke. Sorry, I can't stand him.
What is it about the Duke Blue Devils? What makes the Blue Devils get under your skin?
They're a rival. We have to kind of have a little bit of anger towards them, but
well, there has to be something like that.
I like Duke over Carolina. Carolina's our biggest rival, so I can't pull for them.
Would this make you guys happy if I told you North Carolina lost on the football field?
Yeah.
Wake Forest still, they're not being pumped up over anything. Oh my goodness. And this is how it happened. North Carolina State trying to make something happen. Sexton back to pass. And that one.
Interception.
Yeah, that was picked off, Coach. And that's
all over.
Maryland, yes, it is all over. That's all she wrote.
Hey, Maryland is in pretty good position to win the ACC.
Yeah, make some sense of this conference for me.
I can't.
Okay, well, that's kind of your job. You are the analyst, are you not?
I can't. They all have the same amount of losses. Now, I want to tell you this stat.
Okay.
NC State is 3-0 versus teams from North Carolina.
Okay, gotcha. But you know what? Oh, that's all you need. Well, we have a lot more coming. Wake Forest still trying to smile a little bit. North Carolina State, we need some noise. Coming up next, we've got UConn and Syracuse. It's coming up right here on ESPNU. No alums in the house for that one. Welcome back to SportsCenter U. What are you laughing at, Coach? We were planning something at the end of this show. Boise State and Idaho, they are getting into fisticuffs before this game. And it's Nathan Enderle connecting to Daniel Hardy. And he's rolling over Boise State players. He's still on his feet, Coach. And Coach is playing foosball, so he doesn't care. 81-yard touchdown reception. That's why it's making the highlights. You look at this one more time. How is this physically possible?
I don't know. He's amazing. He stayed on his feet.
I don't know. That's right up there with Coach Mike Godfrey's analysis. Thank you so much for that. Kyle Wilson taking the punt, 78 yards for the touchdown. Boise State has been rolling through this rivalry series, scoring at least 50 points per game. 17-10 at the half. Boise State getting just a little bit of a test. To the Mountain West, BYU and Air Force. Fui, Vakapuna, everybody, Fui!
Fui!
That's what we like. BYU up 7-0. And then BYU coming back with Max Hall to Harvey Unga.
Unga!
Unga!
BYU up 17-14. And then who is it again?
Fui!
Unga! No, not Fui, Unga. Get with the students, Coach. BYU on top 27-14. Max Hall to Austin Colley. Nothing really cool about saying Colley, so we're not going to do it. BYU up top 31-14. Jared Two getting the ball, running 19 yards for the touchdown. And Air Force, well, they're trying to make it close, but right now it's BYU. Was that the North Carolina State? What is this, by the way?
It's the Wolf.
Okay, I got you. Good Wolf.
It's a Wolf.
How about the Cougars,
and
though?
It's a pack.
The pack, okay, but how about the pack of Cougars for BYU? Still alive in the Mountain West?
Still alive. They have to go play Utah at Utah.
Utah! And
if they beat them, they're back in the hunt.
Okay, one more fan participation on the count of three, everybody. Utah! One, two, three.
Utah!
That's how we do it right here on SportsCenter U. More football to come because there is Donald Brown leading the Bowl subdivision with 156.2 rushing yards per game. Wake Forest could have used him. And we're back with SportsCenter U and our friends from North Carolina State and Wake Forest. Right. Yes, they're getting a little tired. It was a tight game. It was close. And North Carolina State won. Penn State also won, taking down Indiana 34-7. Every time I say that, I see the Wake kids going, I wish I could strangle this young man. But they can't because I got the microphone. Ohio State taking down Illinois 32-20. Had to say that again. Utah! We go out west now in the Pac-10, California, Oregon State. Trivia question, if Oregon State wins out, what happens?
They go to a bowl.
They go to the Rose Bowl. They win the Pac-10.
Sure.
Yeah, there's James Rogers, 86 yards. Who can tell me the name of his brother?
Rick.
Jaquiz. Close, though.
That was good.
Mom wanted to name him Rick, but then they decided Jaquiz. Anywho, Sammy Strotter taking this one back.
What's his brother's name?
Samuel? Wait, no, that would be Sammy. Gosh, my Emerson College education coming back to backfire. This sets up a 2-yard touchdown. Beavers up 14-7. And then we have more. This time it's Kevin Riley. Remember, Kevin Riley was the guy we learned about. He couldn't kill the clock, but that's not Kevin Riley, actually. It's James Rogers again. And we just felt like mentioning Kevin Riley, but Oregon State looking good there. So, Coach, it's all yours.
Last comments, ESPN Deportes.
Are there any soccer updates out there?
Football.
This is France. France. Sorry.
Never give the microphone away. What's your final thoughts on the day?
You know, I'm kind of
sad. Did you have fun?
Yeah, it's a good time. Yeah, it's fun.
Now, are you all you going out to eat together?
We're going to sleep.
We're in depression.
Sleep. Loser sleep. What do winners do?
Go to a party.
Drink? Huh?
You mean drink Mountain Dew and Aquafina? We've got it over here, so when you guys want to drink, just ask for Diet Pepsi.
Okay, let me ask you a question. Who's going to play in the national championship game?
Who is?
Football.
Basketball, we got it.
Forget about it.
Florida and Texas.
Florida and
Texas. Smart man.
Who do you think, Spain and Brazil?
I got France against Germany this day.
Okay, good game.
Thierry Henry? Henry? No? Henry? See, Tony Parker? All right, that's the way to do it. Now, this is our good friend. You're actually from France, is that right?
Actually born in France, yes, believe it or not. And I live in North Carolina.
Well, thank you so much, honestly. Thank you to all these guys for coming up. They put up with us for a couple hours now, and I know it's been a little annoying. But you know what we got coming up? We've got UConn, and we've got Syracuse. What does this mean for Greg Robinson?
He has to win this game. And that will not matter.
They're not going to save his job at all?
We need some help here.
Okay, ready, guys? We got the chant. Save Greg's job. Save Greg's job. Save Greg's job. I don't think it's enough, though, Coach. UConn, what does UConn do to win this game?
Run the ball and show up.
And show up. You're going to say it's that easy?
Yeah,
well, you know what?
Quarterback play.
All about North Carolina State. We got to thank everybody so much for joining us right here on the first ever ESPNU tailgate. You got to protect the ball, son, head on a swivel. So for everybody here coming to join us in the thank you so much for joining us. I'm Logan Lindo. He's Coach Mike Godfrey. You are?
Alexa.
You are?
Wolfpack, baby.
Oh, they're a collective Wolfpack. We've had a lot of fun. You can't step on me, son. That's how we do it on the U. Now out to UConn, Syracuse. Save Greg John!